All that sass can go right up your ass.
Where do you think I've been keeping it?
We'll put it back in. Save it for a rainy day.
Ooh.
Oh, fuck yeah.
Hmm.
Well, kind of fuck yeah.
Yeah, that, I just broke to Nick that his character is pregnant. He just found out. No, Dylan, you're fine.
What is it called?
Oh my god. Okay. Everybody else is asking all these questions. Michael just sent me a gif of Miranda Cosgrove drinking a Coke. All right, he gets it. He fucking gets it, fellas. He's on the right page. Oh, shit. All right. We are opening sky high. In fact, even a little bit higher. Interstellarly adrift in space. Mid spike jump. Abort. Fuck you, Nick. Yeah, don't fucking drag. We're 2 seconds in. And Nick's already dragging his little guy onto the map. He's loose in space, guys. Somebody stop him. Sky high, in fact, higher than that. Interstellar mid-spike jump. 2 months into a 3 month journey on, well, depending on where you're coming from. Into a several month long journey. Towards Saragon, a desert system, desert utopia, glass making planet of all sorts. You guys are aboard the ship known as the Isabella, a freighter class ship for both passenger and cargo, independent of Novacore and Micros entirely. You know, taking bids to whoever pays the best. It holds a crew of approximately 30, passenger capacity of about 100, as well as plenty of storage space for all sorts of goods. The luxurious amenities are, well, not to be found, but there are amenities. And the living quarters are comfortable, would be a stretch, but livable is more than adequate. You are all, for one reason or another, on your way to the Saragon system here. Oop, that's the planet. Ignore that for now. The Saragon system, here's the handout for that, actually. A Novacorp territory representing what went wrong with pre-Scream society and post-Scream construction. Or reconstruction, rather. There's a hyper-specialized system, with Saragon 2 being the spearheading planet, producing much of the nearby system's glassware. However, when the Scream occurred and the infrastructure of interstellar trade broke down, with nothing but glass, Saragon 3 kind of, you know, collapsed in on itself. You can't eat glass. Well, you can, but it's not very nutritious. With much of the planet going sort of native, feral, cannibalistic, who knows, 600 years later, a mild reconstruction effort has been established to bring the system back to its former glory. However, due to, you know, complex Novacore politics and stringent regulations, only Saragon 3 has really been deemed habitable again. The gas giant Saragon 1 remains untouched, save for those spacers using it as a refueling station, and Saragon 2 is just a terrible desert wasteland only the foolish would embark to intentionally go to. Saragon 3, however, is a desert paradise compared to the other planets in the system. It has a few cities to name. A couple of reputable locales, whether that be musical clubs, artisan sort of spots to get specialty goods made, and even one starport that's said to be pretty fucking choice when you're trying to get your ship souped up. It's got a few footnotes, and you all have your own reasons for going there, but that's the final destination, a part of the Isabella's sort of transit route, and you guys are maybe about a month out When all of this and Dutch Ricky, when all of this occurs, this being kind of the shit that I've sent you in your chats, we skip forward to just a few days out. You all are guessing you're going to come out of your spike jump at any due time. Arrive in the Saragon system, and then it's only a handful of days before you arrive on the surface of Saragon 3. The planet's going to pull into atmosphere and drop you off, unloading its cargo and its people alike. However, before we land, we open up on a scene at 3 in the morning. Nick, where is Kali at 3 in the morning?
Like fucking sleeping?
Fucking sleeping. Great. You wake up to a plethora of sounds. A blaring alarm, intermittently and deafeningly chiming. A rush of water seemingly coming from all around you, and the banging on metal from the north and south ends of your room. You know that on the north and south ends are two adjoining rooms, and it sounds like people are banging on the wall. Aside from all the noise, you feel a wetness, and you see a very unsettling and rather, dare I say, ominous red light flooding your room as the emergency lighting system has been kicked on. As you kind of wake up from your stupor, your REM sleep, you notice that you are about neck deep in water.
Oh, fuck.
The ceiling of your room has collapsed, and a pipe has ruptured and is pouring water into your room at a sort of rapid rate. You have maybe 10-15 minutes before it's completely filled up. There's a massive hole in your ceiling. You look, your door appears to be jammed shut via some emergency locking mechanism to prevent the ship from flooding. And like I said, all of these alarms are going off. Where's Weevil at 3 in the morning?
I mean, I think Weevil has been spending a lot of his time. Is there like an observation deck? I know this isn't a luxury ship, but I imagine there's like a main area where you can go and just like sit and like maybe they have like cards or something like that, and there's like views of the system.
Yeah, your voice changer is still on, by the way.
Oh, yeah, my bad.
Yeah, there's an observation deck. There's like okay. A sort of a front deck underneath the bridge that you can kind of look out ahead of you. And there's tables and chairs and places to sit and lounge.
Perfect. Is my thing off now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Great. Okay. Yeah. So Weevil has been spending a lot of time on one of the couches there, just kind of sitting there quietly, like almost perfectly still, with like lines of data that just flash by on his HUD, too fast for anyone to actually read. But like he's just reviewing files and stuff like that, and then he occasionally turns, looks out the window for a while, and then goes back to reviewing data. And then I think that's where he is right now. And you know,
around 2:45 in the morning, Weevil, you're relaxing on this couch, so to speak, as much as you can, given your current circumstances. You're spending your time pouring through this data late into the night. You suddenly sort of do the equivalent of a blink, essentially. Your optic sensors, audio sensors, smell receptors, essentially everything shuts down for a split second. And when it reactivates, your clock reads, your internal systems read 2:45 as if no time has passed. However, your surroundings are utterly changed as you are able to sort of see out this front window as you are hurtling past at soaring speeds past Saragon 3, overshooting it entirely. It doesn't take an astronomer or a physicist to know that you will not be stopping on Saragon 3 right now.
Hello, I think we are missing our destination.
Yeah.
You scream out, trying to overpower the sounds of the blaring alarms that are now taking place around you, as very briefly catch the attention of one man in a full sprint going sort of perpendicular to you as he rounds sort of the hallway nearby, looks at you, completely disregards you, and sprints off into the night down another adjoining hallway. Where is Candy at 3 a.m?
Candy is in his dressing room. And by that I mean his small cabin that he's been given, asleep with cucumbers on his eyes and like a face mask and all that stuff.
Okay. Candy is awoken not by the sound of the blaring alarms, because I'm sure he has expert level earplugs on to not get his beauty sleep disturbed, but rather the sudden flooding of light as the cucumbers are lifted from his eyes, as he is lifted from his bed as well, as his eyes flutter open and the gravity has been switched off in your room. Floating around aimlessly, Candy comes to and sees his cucumbers kind of turning head over heel, floating through this gravityless space, the red alarms kind of filling your vision. You pull the earplugs out and wah, alarms sounding at a deafening rate as well. And maybe as Candy goes to he goes to call out for help, laugh to himself at the irony of the situation he's in, or otherwise just kind of take a breath, he realizes that the oxygen has also been cut off in his room. And Janko, where are you at 3 a.m?
If he's not in bed, he would be called to work a night shift. It's up to you where he'd be at that hour. Right.
Perhaps one of the few people to immediately notice what's happened. As you are in the underbelly of the ship, working on engine maintenance, polishing a few grease stains off of some cosmetic parts, doing some cosmetic cleaning, the ship essentially running itself in this final leg of the journey. You notice it suddenly powers down. It just, the entire thing, the sort of tour bus sized engine powering this behemoth of a ship, just goes into reboot mode as it the glows, the fires, the heat, the pistons churning, all dim, cool down, and come to a grinding halt. Checking the diagnostics, everything appears to be on and should be in working order. However, the engine simply does not respond, as you can feel the ship beneath your feet kind of jolt and judder as you're kind of thrown to the ground on one of the catwalks that sort of frame this engine. Losing your balance, and as you stand up, the backup systems all come online, the emergency lights, the alarms, etc., etc. As this happens, the engine sputters and spurts and tries to reboot, but it seems that the quick and sudden jolt forcing it to stop, whatever it was, and the sudden lack of a cool down time mixed with the sudden forcible or forced reboot has caused it to malfunction in a catastrophic way as a piston jams into an otherwise very delicate and very important sort of plasma coil, causing a, to put it lightly, big fucking explosion and setting much of the engine room on fire as it begins to fill with smoke and you are surrounded by sort of flames. We are going to end the campaign there. Everybody go ahead and roll new characters.
Hell yeah. I can't wait for you guys to meet Hedonism Bot. I'm excited.
No, we're going to cut back to Kali LaFlower as... oops, I missed a command there. That means I'm not. Kali LaFlower, as you are in quite the predicament yourself. What do you do?
Okay, well, first off, I go, dude, I didn't even bring my board!
Fantastic.
Yeah, okay.
Well, okay, and you want those to be your last words?
Final words. That's my final offer. Final answer, Regis.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, assess the situation. We said the door is jammed. People in the other room seem to be freaking out as well. There's a hole in my ceiling that water is pouring into.
Mm-hmm. It looks like a pipe has burst and water has just started pouring out of it, and it has partially collapsed your ceiling.
Is there like an area? Does it look like I can, like, is the hole in the ceiling big enough to swim through? Does it seem like there's like a...
Yes, it is big enough to fit through, although you'll have to overpower the streaming water, so it is going to be probably not the easiest thing in the world.
Yeah, I was thinking...
But you can fit.
Yeah, I was thinking, like, does it look like there's a room on the other side, essentially? Like, if I was to find a way to swim up this thing, would I have air?
Potentially. You would essentially be crawling around in the ceiling. You know, there's a room to your north and south adjoining... rooms that people are seemingly banging around on the walls and potentially in trouble as well. But you know that this pipe also runs continually through the ceiling, so there must be somewhere for it to go through.
Okay.
Or it leads somewhere, essentially.
This vibro staff does electric damage, right? Or is it like heat?
It's more kinetic energy. It uses potential kinetic energy to create a sort of like almost like a force shield just around the staff's body. So it's neither electric or heat.
Do I think I could plug this pipe with this vibro staff if I were to turn it on?
No, the vibro staff. So the pipe is big enough for you to crawl through, and the vibro staff is like more of a quarter staff.
I thought the pipe was poking out of the ceiling.
It's kind of both. Is the hole is big enough for you to fit through, and then you could also, if there wasn't a torrent of water streaming from it, you could crawl into this pipe as well. Okay. It's a large pipe that circulates water, it looks like, through the majority of the ship. You also know, for what it's worth, if you were to manage to get up there, if the pipe is busted and all the water is pouring into your room, there's another half of the pipe that the water would normally go through that isn't receiving water right now. So if you could manage to get up into that, you could crawl through a relatively dry pipe.
Yeah. The door, I'm imagining, opens via some kind of like comm pad.
Yeah, there's a comm pad and a digital interface on the side of the door. However, there appears to be sensors, and you would know this just through common knowledge, sensors on the door for situations like this, where if there's a fire in your room, the door might auto-lock to prevent the fire from spreading. So you could potentially trick the sensor as well via, it's at the base of the door, and there's also a compound on the side of the door that you can normally interact with to get this thing open.
Okay, I think while I still have time, while this room is still lit up, I'd love to like take a breath and try to fuck around with the door a bit. Like you said, trick the sensor or fuck around with the compound. Even if it's like, it's frustrating enough, trying to like break the compound, see if that just like auto opens.
Give me a more specific line of action on which of those you would like to try.
I'd like to try the door first. You said there are sensors on the floor. I'd like to at least check those out, see if there's some way I can something I want to take notice, but that's going to lead me into
sure. I'm going to say you don't really need a notice check for this. As you take a breath and swim under the water, you crack your eyes open, and you see that essentially on the bottom sides of the door are these like micro garage sensors, like the invisible laser that kind of goes beneath your garage, that in a more advanced society will do more than just detect if your foot crosses it. They detect for deadly gases, fires, and certain hazards such as water. If you can somehow disable these sensors or otherwise trick them into thinking there's no water between them or over them, you would probably be able to unseal the door manually. Otherwise, you could potentially hack the compad, like override the door, or potentially try and break through as well. Those are all options.
Yeah, let me try and fuck with those things with my little vibro staff.
Okay, are you just gonna try and break them?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
Because I'm not like a tech guy. I wouldn't know how to like break these or whatever.
Yeah. Okay. So you just go to essentially swing on these things. I think that's gonna give me a stab check, which is just the weird catch-all for
with
melee weapons.
Can I argue for like intelligence since I'm aiming, or like dexterity since I'm trying to like jam this thing or off with it? Rather,
I'll take dex. Yeah, intelligence not so much because you're kind of just going to break these. It sounds like, but dex is fair.
All he's known for hitting.
An 8. Yes, with that you manage to kind of jam the tip of the vibro staff that's a little more fine than the rest of the rounded body in between one of the sort of sensors and the door frame, and unwedge it and kind of just crack it just enough so that it's now tilted downwards and malfunctioning. You see the compad on the side of your door exit over or override mode and is now functioning normally. So as you are able, you're able to reach over and place your hand on it, and the door begins to open up, pouring water out into the hallway from the bottom up, sucking you with it as you come spilling out into the hallway, spinning around in a circle on like a in a Looney Tunes manner as you you enter the hallway and on your ass covered in water, soaked to the bone, and now the hallway is slowly filling with water as well, much more slowly, but maybe in an hour this will be a problem. What's your next move?
Help the other passengers.
What'd you say?
The people next to me were stuck in their rooms. Fucking
hell. Okay. Unfortunately do not have access to their sensors because those are on the insides of the door. You would have to manually override their compads on the exterior of the door via, sort of technical workarounds, or you would have to try and break the door down. You can also feel that the ship is somewhat hurtling to the ground to a degree. You can tell it is not flying as normal.
Hmm. Oh shit.
All right, I'll give it a quick go to see if I can like jam at the door to see if I can open it, but I can't risk my own life to try and help these randos. At least not for too long.
Okay, I think give me just another stab check. Okay. This will be a strength one rather than dex, unfortunately.
Oh, well, I don't like that.
Yeah. 6. You bash at this door using the kinetic energy of your vibro staff, this metal stick with a kinetic force sheathing around it, bashing against the metal door, and you're able to make a few dents, and you gather that if you kept at this for about 5 minutes, you could probably break down one of these doors. You might be a little exhausted afterwards, and who knows how much time they have in there.
Yeah, I do not have 5 minutes. I think I just gotta bounce. Unfortunately, maybe I can find someone else to help them if I can find like someone with a gun or like a blowtorch or something. But I'll alert whoever's up there to fucking help them.
Great. You back up from the door and begin to make your way down the hallway, sloshing through the water. You hear the yells of the person on the other side of the door.
Hey, where are you going? Hey, don't leave me.
As you make your way down the hallway, where are you intending to go next?
Anywhere.
Where would you like to go? There are, for what it's worth, this is a state of the art freighter class ship. So there are there's a bridge and a command center. There are, of course, all of the accoutrements such as like a med bay, a cafeteria, an armory, anything you could want, cargo storage, the engine room, as well as a number of lifeboats, small pods that can be ejected within the system and can be piloted to
I believe any sort of escape pod is what I'm going for.
Okay, so you're going to head for one of the escape pods. Easy enough. You're heading in that direction. Cut back to, I believe, K. Weevil was next. Yeah.
Oh, shit. Who's K. Weevil?
Yeah.
Yeah, so, Weevil, that guy you mentioned when Weevil was like, we are missing our destination. Yep. Which direction... Did he look like he was a crew member, or did he look like a disgruntled passenger?
He looked like a scared, shitless passenger.
Okay. Which direction is the bridge?
Directly above you.
Okay, so I'm going to look for a way up that is the quickest, assuming there's maybe a ladder or something.
You'll have to go through a stairwell, like down a hallway through a stairwell up and around, but it'll take you less than a few minutes to get there if you book it.
Okay. Yeah, so Weevil is going to book it, and he is, meanwhile, keeping an eye out for anyone that he's passing, and taking note of which direction they're heading.
Okay. You rush up and around and through some hallways, stairwells, and passageways, passing a number of passengers, most of them heading in the opposite direction of where you're going. It doesn't seem like the bridge is a hot spot to gather right now. You gather that while they are all over the place and not everybody's heading in one direction, most of these people are probably rushing towards the limited number of escape pods that are on this ship.
Not me.
At one point, as you are rushing towards an escape pod, Collie, you pass by a massive fucking robot running in the wrong direction. You make it to the bridge within a few minutes, Weevil, and you can tell that it is not normally accessible via passengers, and currently that is no exception.
Okay, I'm going to... Well, first off, I'm banging on the door, and I'm saying...
Alert! 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 We are hurtling towards the ground! Is anyone in there? Let me in! Is anyone in there?
And he is barring... Assuming he doesn't get a response...
You do get a response. You do get a response.
Okay.
Yeah, don't assume. All right, you know what they say. You hear over the PA system, essentially the... this is your captain speaking. We are currently hurtling towards Saragon 2 at 20,000 feet. You hear over that loudspeaker used to make starship-wide announcements. We are very aware of the situation. Please stop banging on the door. You are adding to my stress right now, and I can't take it anymore.
All right, so Weevil says... Do you need... Oh, sorry. I don't want to stop using the filter now.
Do you need any expertise in programming? I'm able to do that. I may see if I can circumvent the systems and jumpstart something.
There's a very long... coming from...
We do not have long system. Please, time is of the essence.
Can you give me a... talk? Charisma check?
Dang, okay, talk.
Let's go, Weevil.
4.
And a 4. It is advisable that all passengers make their way to the escape pods while there are still some available. Is the response.
I hope you are more than a red smear by the time that the ship hits the ground. And he turns and...
Weevil just begins booking it. Yeah, so...
As you run down the hallway, you hear a very faint, what the fuck?
Yeah, he is now making his direction through the crowds. He's not, like, stomping on anyone because he's aware of his size, but he's also, like, not being necessarily gentle in trying to get to the life... the exits.
Okay. Making your way to an escape.
It's a song, you know, like he's in the crowd and pushing his way through too.
Mm-hmm. All right. We cut back to Candy floating aimlessly in his room, gravityless, oxygenless. What do you do?
Okay, so gravityless, oxygenless. Looking, so did Roadie bunk with me? Probably not, right? Like he has his own room.
No, he would be in an adjoining room, right next to you.
Okay, I'm gonna try and get to the adjoining room. If anybody can save Candy, it's Roadie. So, Candy will start like almost like swimming to the room. That's connected to try and get help.
Sure. You look over and your door to the door of your room in the hallway is actually open already. And that's a bad sign because you swim into the hallway. Guess what? There's no gravity or oxygen here either. You look over and you swim over just a few feet down the hallway and you see Roadie is still asleep. Floating just through the air.
Okay, I'm gonna slap him.
Okay, you manage to swim over to his room and give him a 1-2, the candy special, and his eyes kind of drunkenly, slovenly kind of flutter open halfway before he realizes what's going on as he goes to speak to you and just clutches his throat a little bit. You two are reunited and in a bad situation.
Save him, yeah. Roadie. Yeah, Candy is like a fucking wimp. All right, so looking around, my assumption is that there would be some sort of way to cut off a portion of the ship that is like damaged, maybe, or has this. Like, is there a place that we can go to, like, maybe lower some sort of wall to reinstate the oxygen? Is there anything like that around me?
Yeah, so if you swim down the winding sort of a slightly curved corridor to either end, you will see that the corridor, much like a subway train car, has a hard door that has been manually, or sort of rather automatically, shut to prevent this lack of oxygen breach, wherever it is occurring from spreading to the rest of the ship.
Okay, I will motion for Roadie to fling me over there, and he can, I guess, swim over there himself. but, you know...
Roadie begrudgingly applies by sort of getting into a ball and then kicking you forward.
Nice. Okay, so I'm floating through the air towards it. Is there a way to kind of... Yeah, separate that, like, give us oxygen and gravity back? Is there, like, essentially a big red button that says, make bad thing go away?
Unfortunately, it is not going to be that simple. There is a comm pad on the side of the door, a sort of data interface, that you could potentially... it is currently in override mode, so, hey, don't touch me. I'm doing something that's very important so we don't destabilize the rest of the ship kind of mode. And you would have to essentially hack past that a little bit, kind of go through some programs and workarounds. You could also potentially try and brute force your way past the door or smash the comm pad and maybe that'll fix it. Otherwise, you can attempt to find the oxygen leak and plug it, and that should also shut things, the sort of override mode down.
Yeah. Is there anything in the environment that, like for instance, are things being pulled a certain direction? Does it look like, you know, there's things moving towards some sort of breach?
Ooh, very smart. Give me a notice wisdom check.
Notice with whizzing.
Give me a piss check. A four. Whatever this oxygen leak is must be so subtle, unfortunately, that things are not being obviously pulled in any one direction, and they appear to just be aimlessly floating about. Your perception is not maybe the keenest at the moment, as you are beginning to get lightheaded from the lack of oxygen. You do not immediately see anything. However, what I will do as well, because he's here, Roadie is going to look as well.
Nice, Roadie.
Yeah. Yeah. If anybody's going to save him, it's going to be Roadie, like you said. Roadie begins to try and speak, but can't, for obvious reasons, as he points over to a... He points over to a section of the hallway that appears to have a golf ball hole in it, where the floor meets the ceiling. And then Brody actually looks up and he sees that where the ceiling meets the floor in a diagonal line, there's another golf ball sized hole that would line up trajectory wise. It looks like some like piece of shrapnel fired by some sort of extremely powerful force shot through the ship's body.
Ooh. Okay. And I go back to the room and grab the cucumber slight. No, I'm just kidding.
Oh, man! Dude, that would be so fucking funny.
That would, I mean, it would never work, which is why I'm not going to do it. You know what? Andy does have, though, and Roadie presumably would be closer to the room. Candy does have a lot of rope, which he uses for tantric sex and for BDSM. Maybe stuffing the hole with that could temporarily ease the issue. I know Roadie is good at fixing stuff. I don't know what he has on him that could be applicable in this situation. Like, I don't think he has like fucking Flex Seal tape on him. You know what I mean?
He sawed too many boats in half before leaving for this, and he used all of his Flex Seal. But that's a good point. Candy sign language kind of motions for Roadie to swim into the room, and Roadie does that, and he tosses you a couple of long strings of rope. Candy, as a tantric sex master, you think that if you tied some sort of like Gordian knot style knot in the rope, that would be sort of a big enough and sturdy enough circumference to really jam itself in there and potentially fool the sensors of the ship. So I need you to
give us like a little way out. Yeah.
I think I need you to roll me a. I mean, I want to say survive. Dexterity check would be my initial pick, but
I'm not great at that. But
yeah, so this is just a six. This would be a perfect opportunity to reiterate the openness of the system as a side note. Where Dylan would have had a very ample opportunity right there to say, well, Candy uses this rope to perform tantric sex. Can I roll a perform check instead? And I would have said yes to that, which I know Candy is better. Yeah. So like, think outside the box. If I ask you to roll a check, do not be afraid to ask for something better as long as you know in your heart of hearts you're not being a dick about it. You're not like, can I actually roll a program check to tie this knot? Like, shut up. You know you can't roll a program check.
I wouldn't have thought that for perform, but that's a good point. I mean, I'll do it if I can.
Unfortunately, not now. You've already rolled. And also, with a six.
I have one other question about that when you get a chance. Sorry.
What's up? We'll address it.
Could you also say, like, all right, so you say perform dex. Could I argue perform charisma or something like that?
Yeah, as long as it makes sense.
Okay.
As long as whatever. I'm going to give you my top and instinctive pick. Survive to tie a knot dexterity because it's with your hands, right? Boom, easy. You could easily argue perform wisdom as well, you know? I remember how to tie this knot that I normally don't use for fucking. You know, so just feel free to think outside the box. Either are replaceable. I'm going to ask for one versus the other, but yeah.
Cool.
I also noticed, Dylan, your hit points seem a little off. You have more hit points than you have, I think.
Are you sure? Candy has one hit point, and he has one hit point currently.
No, but it's wrong on the sheet. It says more than
Candy
one.
Candy has one hit point.
It says three out of one right now.
Yeah. So okay. I see what you mean.
Okay.
The issue was the base, not the. The total. Have a
six. Okay.
Okay. So now it's back
with
to
a six.
1-1.
With a six, you are just barely able to get these knots tied. Rather,
move over, Sting.
As you go to plug one in the hole, Roadie nicks the middle of the rope, so you can take the other knot and jam it in the other hole. And unfortunately with a six, as you stuff it in, Candy's frail constitution begins to give way. Why don't you give me a physical save?
But Candy is so tough, except for in all the ways that he's not. All right, physical save.
Alex, if you kill Candy today, we're not friends anymore.
Oh, nice.
I'm not going to hurt.
Yeah, Dylan said, oh, nice. I can't wait for you guys to not be friends anymore. Because Candy is made of fucking paper. Anyway, no, Candy's immortal, of course. Very clearly, you almost pass out as the gravity turns back on, things shift, oxygen fills your lungs, and you fall to the ground, you know, just straining your lungs, desperately trying to catch up, as Roadie grumbles in the corner, having hit his head during the fall. Automatically unseal.
It does make sense that Candy would survive because of all the autoerotic asphyxiation he puts himself under.
Roadie looks down at Candy's erection and quietly grumbles to himself.
Yeah.
This is all too common. You guys are able to progress to other parts of the ship now. Where would Candy like to go?
Did the captain announce over the intercom system where we should go?
No, there's been no news.
Okay. Are there windows that we can look out? What would we know? We're in space. So I was going to say to determine our orientation, but it doesn't matter. We're in space. Okay.
You rush down towards the hallway, and you are actually able to look out like a porthole window kind of deal. And for the most part, there's a whole lot of nothing. And they are actually normally just showing holographic images over the windows of just like different sceneries. Each hallway is usually showing like a snowy mountain, and then the hallway next to it is like a vast desert, just for like things to look out onto. Those holograms obviously are not functioning in the emergency backup system, and you can see for the most part the inky vastness of space. However, as you kind of look down and kind of press your face against the glass, you guys can tell that you guys are at like a 45-degree angle, hurtling towards a giant desert planet, and it kind of doesn't look like the one you're supposed to be going towards, although, you know, how would you know one lump of sand from the other? Either way, you're heading towards a land of mass way too quickly at way too steep of an angle.
Then can I use a no? Before I even ask this, is there any like crew members or anybody else around that could help us? Or is it just me and Roadie?
As you stand there looking out the window for a second, you hear a couple of pairs of footprints on like boots on metal, just huffing it down the hallway. As you see two people dash by a T intersection heading perpendicular to you. So they kind of just pass from left to right across your view.
All right, Candy will call out, "You two, wait!"
Oh, I already hate him.
give me a talk charisma check.
Would I be able to use connect since I'm, you know, I'm good at connecting with people? Would I be able to use that to try and...
This is one of the exceptions where I'll say no. I'd take perform instead. I know I realize it's the same for you, but connect is more of like a, you know what? I'll take connect. You go, "You two, wait," as long as you yell out your name. You identify yourself as Candy Sweetstar.
"It is me, Candy Sweetstar. Sing it to the stars, please stop."
That makes it a connect check. That makes it your ability to connect with other people.
With charisma?
Mm-hmm. You hear a guy yell, "Fuck you!" As he continues to run, and a woman's voice goes like, "No, John, wait! I love Candy!" And she rushes back around the corner, kind of just peering around. She's like, What do you need, Mr. Candy? What do you need, Mr. Sweetstar?"
"I need you to direct me, and of course my help here, to wherever the escape pods are. Maybe you can take us with you."
"Of course, follow me. Me and my husband are on the way. Come with us." And they'll direct you to
happily prance after them, waving Roadie along.
Yeah, he grumbles and follows. And the four of you start rushing towards an escape pod.
Quick question. How do I know this is like completely off topic. How do I change my picture from Fat Chungus to Candy?
If you go to the right and you hit add,
button. I'm so glad you asked. I've been staring at that for so long.
You guys have the pictures open? Okay. What's wrong with you?
I'm sorry, say it again.
Go to the bottom right corner under the chat where it says as and choose who you want to type as.
Yeah, okay. I can, for example, right now I'm the system.
Gotcha.
And now I'm New Texas.
Oh, okay.
This is the first time in years we've all been our characters in the image.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, because like I was looking at this and I was like, wow, you guys look really cool. And then you have fucking Fat Chungus on the transparent background that isn't transparent. I was like, we gotta do this. All right, thanks.
Oh boy. All right. We cut to Janko in the fiery ship's bay, as the engine has recently essentially exploded. And catwalks are collapsing, metal frames are creaking. Engines are sputtering, fire is sizzling and burning. You are stuck in a position at the moment where you're on a long catwalk that was destabilized in the explosion. There's lots of piping and valves and pipes and gadgets and sprockets and doodads around you that you could potentially cling on to. However, they are all scalding hot at the moment, as they have been sort of, the heat has kind of caused them to, you know, essentially become part-time superconductors for the heat, and they are glowing red. Ahead of you and behind you are wildfires, and unfortunately the halogen fire suppression system seems to have not activated at the current moment. It seems that whatever disrupted the engine has disrupted that as well, and it needs to be manually triggered. However, it is about 60 feet ahead of you and through a torrent of flames.
Okay, so that's out of the question if it's through fire.
Unless you can find a way to remotely activate it.
I'm just gonna start grabbing all my gear that would have been around me so I don't lose it, pocketing it, grabbing my snacks and shit I was snacking on.
You're turning off nuts, you're leaving them out of the air.
I'm turning off the hard rock in my earpiece, and I'm just trying to focus. Am I in zero G or is it normal right now?
You are in normal gravity. Candy was the only one in zero G.
Okay, if I have a way to remotely clear a path toward this damaged area, I would love to. If not, I'm gonna try to manually block it and then get over the fire.
Sorry, one more time.
If I have any way that I can remotely, like, turn something off to, like, stop the fire.
You don't have, like, a remote control, but it's sort of like a, imagine essentially a fire alarm, right? Pull in case of fire kind of deal. Yeah. So if you can figure out a way to get that to pull down, you're gonna shoot it?
No, I'm gonna troubleshoot it. I'll try to actually make it work, even if it's jammed or damaged or whatever. Can I do a fix or a
okay? But it's check? It's 60 feet away is the problem. You remember? Yeah, there's a fire alarm 60 feet away, and if you can pull it, halogens fire suppression will turn on. But there's a fire between you and the fire alarm, so your remote activation would be figuring. I don't know, tying a really long lasso and throwing it across. That's the dumbest idea ever, because I don't want to answer it for you, but that's the kind of thing you would have to do if you want to pull this. Otherwise, like I said, there are vertical pipes, vents, gadgets, and doodads that you could potentially hop off this catwalk and climb onto. However, they're scalding hot, so you would need a way to suppress your body from the heat, or otherwise kind of try and just bear the brunt of the damage and see if you can hold on. Well, that's pretty risky. There's also open air above you, so if you can somehow figure out a way to turn off the gravity, you could float around, and that would also suppress the fire.
Okay, if there's any like, any medium to small like pieces of metal or piping I could use, I could maybe jam. I could create like a makeshift monkey bar system, where I can use the metal, like, on this burning pipe, not touch it with my hands, and kind of like very quickly scamper across it by like.
Okay. I'm imagining almost using a scrap piece of pipe, which there are plenty of. There's shrapnel, there's sheet metal, there's pipes all around you on the floor that you can grab. They're just not connected to anything. Almost using it as like a salmon ladder kind of deal as you're jumping and hooking between the pipes. That's cool as hell. I think for that, I would ask for an exert strength or dex. I think either would work. That would be my first pick.
I think I'm going to do dex, which I think is higher. Oh, cool.
Yeah, your dex is plus one.
Okay, cool. If I die, no, that's pretty good.
Ooh, damn, that's like the second best roll you can get.
Yeah, almost. Actually, yeah, you know. You
oh no! 14. Anything worse than one? It's two ones. Oh no.
five and a five. Yeah. You with an 11, you manage to get. Yeah, you do this with relative ease. Paligon nimbleness is you know, you're able to support your body weight quite easily because you don't weigh a lot. As you're hooking between these hot metal pipes with your cool metal pipe, the heat only transferring momentarily before you're airborne again, landing on another set, airborne again, so on and so forth, over the flames. Your tail only is singed a small portion as you land next to the halogen fire suppression system, are able to activate it with a pull of a lever and a twist of a switch, and foam begins to rain down from the ceiling, coating almost everything in this room, you included, killing the fires, cooling down the hot metal pipes, and unsealing the doors to the engine bay. It is no longer a critical hazard to the rest of the ship. Where would you like to go next?
All right. I think I've quieted down a little bit in this no longer flaming room. I'm going to call to make sure there's nobody else working in this area that could be hurt or trapped.
There was one or two other people on shift with you in this massive engine chamber. You yell out and there's no response.
Okay. Well, I might have been on maybe late shift alone or something.
No. There was one or two other people in the engine room with you, on late shift with you, but you, as you yell out, you don't hear a response. They've either potentially somehow gotten out, have died, or maybe they don't hear you over the chaos. Who's to say?
Okay, before I run out into like the civilian sector or whatever, I want to do my due diligence and try to like jog down the length of this engine, make sure there's nobody near me or accessible before I escape.
Okay. You give me a notice wisdom check.
Sure.
You do a quick run, and between the extremely dim lights of the red backups, sort of deafening alarm that is just kind of overwhelming some of your other senses, the thick layer of foam that is now coating everything, and the general chaos of the exploded pieces of the engine room, you don't see either of your two coworkers. At a glance, you could potentially do a much more in-depth look and start turning over pieces of scrap metal, but you realize that your time here is potentially limited. Good. As you know, more than anyone, with this kind of catastrophic engine failure, the ship is, best case, aimlessly floating and slowly destabilizing through the boundless void of space, and potentially worst case scenario, going to collide with a giant rock, meteor, or planet in 12 seconds or, you know, potentially more. An indeterminate amount of time.
Okay, I'm going to take that as a good sign. I'm just going to leave. I figured.
Okay. Where are you heading, just for the escape pods, or?
Not the pods first. First, I want to see if I can... I guess I'm... gonna check out the crew quarters, make sure if there's anybody that's like asleep somehow. Is it flooded or what?
You're gonna start. I mean, that's a big question. Is crew quarters is a vague statement, as people, this is a passenger ship and there's people stepped all over. You come across one hallway that is, it has a locked door, manual override, or automatic override rather, and you see that water is piled up against the porthole of the door. It is completely flooded, and opening it would probably cause a bad depressurization flooding situation. You run down another hallway and you see that there is a hole in the ship where everything pretty much has been sucked out of it. It is gravity-less, oxygen-less, and if you were to open this door, you would be sucked out into the void of space as well. And kind of so it goes on, each kind of separate length of the ship you get to has a different problem to a different severity. As you are running around, I don't know how to stress this anymore. If you want to kind of play hero and save everybody, that's cool, but you're probably going to get blown up with the ship.
I'm not. I don't want to be the person to press a button and depressurize a whole fucking chamber and kill survivors. So I'm going to keep running where it's safe and follow the crowd and, I guess, go towards the escape pods because...
Yeah. Okay. First to arrive is Cully the Flower, as you are running down a long strip of where the western half of the ship, where the escape pods are. There are several kind of escape pod bays where there's, you know, five or six of them on several different levels. There's east, west, three levels each. They each fit about six people in them. And you get to the Western Bay, sorry, and on the floor you're on, there's only one escape pod remaining, but as you peer into it, nobody's in it.
Okay, hop in.
You hop in? Well, do you immediately take off? Fuck the other five people that might take this boat.
I'm thinking I could travel through space solo.
Oh no, this one malfunctions. It explodes as soon as you're...
Okay, how about this? I want to count, after I hopped in, I want to count how many seats are in it.
Six.
Okay, how many total people could realistically fit in this?
Six.
Oh, okay. It's like a
yeah. It's not. It's not. There's six spaces in standing room. It is like six spaces in a center console. Imagine like almost like a large, like on the interior at least, a spherical hotel, or not a spherical hotel, spherical restaurant booth that goes three quarters of the way around a central console, and you have to kind of step up onto the seating portion to get around it. So you would get six people shoulder to shoulder, and then the central console is how you control it. So there's no, if once you, once the seats are filled up, there's nowhere to be.
Okay, I think what I would do is start yelling out, like, dudes, this way! Come on! And I'm waiting to see if anyone comes along. Do I hear footsteps?
You hear as two massive mechanical footsteps pound on metal as Weevil. You hear a very strangely relaxed voice coming from one of the only escape pod on this floor as you peer around the corner and see a relaxed gentleman. Okay. I guess just for posterity's sake, now that you guys are like seeing each other, what does Weevil see when he looks into this pod? What does Kali look like? I know we've kind of been over this loosely with each other, but I think now's a good time just to solidify everything.
Me or what does Weevil see? Do we want Weevil to describe? Yeah, I like that.
I'll describe your character for you, Nick.
Yeah.
No. You can't put Weevil with things, like a robot.
Weevil turns on his biometric scanners and sees Kali's micro penis. Yeah, what does Weevil see? And that's a question for you, Nick, obviously, because...
All right. Here, let me pull up my art. What Weevil sees is a pretty lanky man, relatively cut, but definitely not like working out muscular. He about 5'10", I'd say. Big, long, flowing, dirty blonde locks. A pair of pink, like Wayfarer shades that are not prescription. A pink Hawaiian shirt. A very, very deep white V. A very, very deep white V.
The deepest cut you've ever seen.
Yeah.
You can see nip.
Yeah. A cool pair of shorts that are like that quick dry material. And a very, very loud pair of flippy floppies.
Okay.
And he's looking at him with this kind of like distressed smile. He's got all right teeth, nothing crazy, but he's a relatively handsome guy, not too handsome. It's like, oh my god, there's another bro. Are you like a droid for this ship?
Yeah. So we will.
Kali looks back. What do you see? Yeah.
Yeah. So you hear the followed by the thudding of metal on metal as a massive, like, his height's gonna change until I officially lock it. I'm gonna say 7'3". He's like a 7'3" steel and aluminum automaton with battered blue and light blue paint on his chassis and you know, the designation W3-VIL on his right shoulder pauldron. And he is like doing like the fucking Forrest Gump run, you know, like arms like swiveling at like perfect 45 degree angles as he goes. And he comes around and he stops and he very quickly, he has like this large central chassis, like his chest, and he's got a big glowing blue like thing on the middle of it. And you see the light kind of dart left, dart right, dart up, dart down, almost like it's surveying you. But if you look up, he's got this little pop-up display with like a smiling LED face that looks literally like, you know, like an emoji face. And he stops and the little face on his head turns into like the dot loading symbol of like the circle chasing circles. And all of a sudden you hear,
"You seem relaxed. This is a crisis. Are you okay? Do you require medical assistance?"
"Oh, it's just behind my shades. Look." And Kali takes off his shades, and you just see the absolute horror and panic but he's still somehow smiling.
All right, yeah. Weevil barrels towards you, and with like he stops on a dime, and so you hear dun dun dun, and then like as you're like flinching back, maybe he gently takes the shades and he puts them back on your face, probably slightly crooked, and he says,
"Please do not take them off again. That was disturbing."
And then he enters the life pod with you and tries to make himself as small as possible, sitting in one of the seats.
Okay. A moment goes by and you guys hear kind of the weird scaly kind of plaps of like on metal as this red-scaled Thrax, kind of scrawny-looking dude, kind of sprints around the corner in a vac suit with the helmet off as he's huffing and puffing. I'm not too late. Here, scoot aside. And he kind of very scrambles in next to you guys. He goes, thank God I made it. Should we take off now?
I think we
are others on the ship.
I don't see anybody. I don't see anybody else here. We should go.
We should try to we should try to fill the seats, you know?
I think we need another 5 minutes.
And the facial display turns to a 5.
It's awesome. Can Candy call out from the hallway trying to make sure that nobody leaves without him?
Shh, I'll get to you. Don't worry. As this fella he huffs and puffs a few bits, and he's like, okay, fine, whatever you guys say. And at that point, a confused and worried looking Palgan rounds the corner. Jenko, what do they see as you kind of stumble into the west wing on the uppermost floor? After you've run the fucking gauntlet at this point, as you have not only looked for passengers and crowds and people, and you know, people in danger, and you've just come across wing after wing of collapsed architecture and holes in the ships and flooded sections. Eventually, and you've actually gone to the floor. But you've worked your way from the bottom up, and you realize that this is actually the one you finally come to on the top floor is the last escape pod on the west half of this ship. You're not sure about the east half. But you were beginning to get worried that your diversion had, made you not so lucky and cost you an escape route. However, you see a half-filled escape pod, and they see...
So the parts of him that are not covered in like foam from these extinguishers is just covered in like oil and just smeared whatever from the engines. Despite that, he's just like anxiously digging in his pockets for some of his snacks and just eating all of it as he's running. Sees the escape pod and just kind of like hear his feet just like skirt on the... on the polished floor. He just like scampers back towards you, like, hey, I'm still here, I'm here, keep it open. And he just kind of like sprints into the pod without even asking and takes a seat. He's like, all right,
I am sorry, that seat is taken
by me, you're right.
Yes, you're correct, that was the joke.
And the 5 on Weevil's display ticks down to a 4.
Yeah.
But... I see.
Polly goes, dude, it tells jokes too.
A moment goes by as you guys are waiting, and you hear the heavy huffing and puffing of almost like combat boots on metal as this woman comes grinding and skidding to a halt, almost action hero style, as she rounds the corner. She looks at you, all this weird array of people in the escape pod, huffing and puffing. Oh, thank God, there's one left. Everything on the east side is completely gone. And she begins to make her way in. She's like a human woman, maybe mid-30s. Short, like bobbed black hair, and she's wearing kind of like combat gear and like like a almost like military issued like leather harness with some carrying bags, and like she has like combat shin pads and stuff like that on. She appears to be like a little more rough and tumble. Like for some reason, it looks like she was like, you know, maybe she's some sort of bounty hunter, a merc or something like that. She's more well equipped than like your standard citizen, essentially, but she's not like wearing like cop gear or anything. And she squeezes in next to you guys. Just
we're
then.
Four out of six.
Mm-hmm. And just then, as Candy, Roadie, and Mr. and Mrs.
Mr. and Mrs. not the protagonist.
Mr. and Mrs. Let's see. I'm gonna make them. They're gonna be Greek. Mr. and Mrs. Raptus. round the corner, you guys all hear from the escape pod just a plethora of pop, 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 a small army of feet compared to what you guys have heard before. As four people round the corner, two civilians, a grungy-looking drunken biker, and the wondrous, fabulous Candy Sweet Star, the protagonist of all of your stories. Dylan, you describe your character and your henchman as well.
Sure. Candy, first you see his, how should I put this? The way he runs is the first thing that you notice, as he holds almost like his arms held up like T-Rexes almost, the hands swinging passively as he runs, almost prancing, his feet barely touching the ground as he hops towards the, getaway, life raft. His hair is shoulder length blonde. He has a purple streak running through it. His roots are starting to grow out at this point. He's got a little bit of brown in there, although he's, you know, does his best to hide it. He's still wearing his stage makeup, despite the fact that he was sort of in the middle of sleeping. He still has remnants of almost like night makeup, right? Like the type of makeup he wears to bed. And is still wearing his suit. You may have actually seen it. He obviously was the entertainment for the ship. So the getup that he'd wear every night, which is the same that's pictured in his character art, is exactly what he's wearing now. He is a little red in the face, not used to exercise. And behind him, of course, is Roadie, aka Roadie Roadkill, who is just a gruff looking, it's like, let's say, 6 foot or so. Again, shoulder length hair, although his is, brown and gray. And he kind of just looks like shit. I mean, he looks like he's been filtered through gravel a couple of times before he's gotten here.
Poor guy.
And that's Andy and Roadie for you.
I just love the fucking major difference in their names, bro.
Yeah.
That's yeah. And of course you have Mr. and Mr. Raptus, who are a mid-30s sort of couple, wearing generally just civilian clothes. She's wearing a nice, they're both wearing pajamas. They're wearing matching pajamas, like those soft tops that button up on the front, and pajama pants, and they have bunny slippers on, although each of them only have one slipper on at the moment. Their hair is all disheveled. Mrs. Raptus's hair is in curlers.
Do they have the poop hole in the back?
They do not. They're not pajama onesies, minor, you know, they're just matching, they're classy pajama tops and bottoms, all right? They're made of silk.
They've got their initials monogrammed on their left. Now, let's not make them too unlikable.
Yeah. They actually do have their initials monogrammed on the front end, and both of them are P-A-R, weirdly enough. They have the same initials. And they, being the ones leading Candy and Roadie, immediately climb into the escape pod, filling up 6 out of 6 seats.
All right, Weevil reaches up for the door hatch, and he's like, ready.
Okay, so the seats are all filled before Candy and Roadie, or are
yes.
the seats...
The seats are all filled before Candy and Roadie as the two people leading you climb into the escape pod. And as you round the corner about 10, 15 feet behind them, you look and you see five people in a robot looped around this escape pod. And there's no room. There physically is no room for you to get in here.
Wait, maybe I can like suck in my gut or something.
That would be good, and maybe one of you can join him and I can have a seat to myself. I will remind you that without me, there is no music. If I die, so does the music for this universe. So if one of you wouldn't mind getting up to share with this thing.
At this point, the short-haired military woman pipes up and she goes, "That's no good. Sucking in your gut's not going to do it, fellas. This thing only has enough capacity to carry so much weight. We cram any more people in here, we're not making it anywhere. Sorry, but Fancy Pants, was it? You're going to have to stay on the exploding ship. Unless anybody wants to give up their seat." I didn't think so.
I do not want to die.
No, that's bullshit. Okay, maybe we could get him in. I could sit in his lap and strap myself in.
What did I just say about the weight? It doesn't matter if we tape him to the ceiling. We're as heavy as we can get.
There's no other escape pods, right?
Yeah, you looked around and she even chimes in. And she goes, "I just came from the east side. There's nothing." Well, at this point, Mrs. Raptus reaches out and grabs Candy by the palm, and she's like, "I'm so sorry. I love your music. I'll remember you."
Well, look, you guys all came last. Maybe you should like rock, paper, scissors for it.
That's a good idea. I'll be all three.
Mr. Raptus looks over and goes, "Fuck you. What's your deal, man? Sunglasses?"
Look, bro, I got here first. Don't look at me. And fucking colleague straps himself in.
I hate to do this, but if I need to, I will have my friend here remove somebody. And please, do not take it personally. I am so important. I am so important.
You're impotent? Yeah.
Weevil turns to Candy and he goes,
"Yeah. Did you say that if you died, there would be no more of your music left in the world, Mr.?"
I actually want to roll to see if I recognize him, because I have a very funny thing in mind.
I think that would give me a no intelligence check. Would be.
I want to. Can I argue connect intelligence? Because I have
absolutely. If, connect is great.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah, especially if actually that does literally nothing for me. Never mind. That's a fucking moron. All right, so I'll roll. Yeah, that's a 9. Because I think Jeeves would have listened to this music if this guy's a little past his prime. And Weevil probably has some recording of Candy, so he goes.
"Did I hear you correctly when you said that if you died, there would be no more music left in the world?"
And then he,
that is correct.
The little display on his face turns to a floating music note, and he plays Candy's most popular song.
Mrs. Raptus begins grooving immediately. She's like, "Oh, I love this one."
If one of you were to give up your seat for me, I would sing at your funeral. Well, I would let you play my music at your funeral.
So Alex, how is this thing piloted exactly? Is there like a steering wheel, or is it auto-guided?
For the most part, it's going to be auto-guided. You plug in the coordinates of essentially the nearest, like the big red launch button will automatically seek out the largest planetary mass and autopilot you there. There are controls for overriding it and piloting within the system. This thing cannot go interstellar, though.
Yeah. Well, like, I've never driven one of these before, but the steering wheel looks kind of similar to my old van. I could try to overshoot the planet, and if we squeeze in...
That is not encouraging.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
I think it would be best served if we landed this on planet, because I do not believe we would have the ability to get to Saragon 2.
No, like overshoot because it's too heavy, because... fucking Fancy Pants over here needs to come on.
You see, Candy's
worry, it would be impossible for him to get on.
Yeah, I like to imagine
at this point,
Weevil is like smack in the middle, like turning back and forth, like this giant, like taking up one wall of this thing.
Yeah, smacking people on the side of the head. At this point,
as the thing is exploding.
Yeah, I was gonna say, at this point, the ship rumbles quite a great degree. The escape pod is now almost like partially, it almost like partially detaches by like an inch or two, basically. Like, you can tell, like, the mount that it's internally mounted to, that mounts it to the greater part of the ship, kind of shifts and creaks a little bit as Candy is now, like, at a 2-degree angle, standing outside the ship to the rest of you.
I wave.
And Candy, he's starting to get a little agitated.
Don't you understand? If I die, there will be no one to sing. I am the most important. I am the celebrity here. You are nothing. And he just starts like feeling and like facing. And he's gonna try and pull the girl that likes him. He's gonna try and pull her out.
Give me an athletics check, or not athletics, an exert strength, as I would say.
Let's go, Candy.
Yeah, she's gonna roll her check too.
You are nothing.
I am the main character here.
Yeah.
Mr. and Mrs. Rab, this okay. More like Mr.
Exert
Rab.
Exert strength.
Yeah.
Oh no.
Yeah, I mean, not
specialty. A 6. You are able to overpower this defenseless woman. And you yank her by the wrist out of this pod as she goes crashing onto the floor on her hands and knees, skidding across the snake metallic floor.
Muscle out the other one.
The husband stands up to what the fuck, and he goes to retrieve his wife. And as he gets up, Roadie is going to just swing on him. I'm gonna roll an exert strength check for Roadie as well. Only a 4. Let's see if this guy does any worse. That's a 3 and a 1, of course. Roadie struggles with this guy for a moment as he goes to punch him, and the guy kind of blocks it, and they get into a grapple. And as they're kind of pulling and yanking on each other, kind of trying to get their shirts over each other's head to hockey punch each other and wrestle each other away from this escape pod. What are the rest of you guys doing? Is this clinch is lasting for more than like an instant?
I
imagine Candy immediately gets in the ship.
He gets in the ship and he buckles into the seat that he pulled the woman out of.
I was going to say, I reach up for the hatch and I look at the others and I like do like the closest thing a robot can do to a shrug. Like, do I close the door? But I don't actually do anything. I'm not. I just got my hand on the lever ready to close it once I guess we've got 6 people inside because
I look at Weevil's face and I go, but we've only got 1 left.
Why doesn't everybody, except for Candy, why doesn't everybody else give me a notice wisdom check?
Okay. 8 for Weevil.
A 6 for Jenko, an 8 for Weevil, and a 4.
I guess just for establishing precedent, notice whiz is basically this game's equivalent of a perception check, right?
As close as we're going to get,
It's not something we can negotiate because, like, you don't know why we're rolling it.
You can. In this case, what? No. In this case, this is to strictly notice something. So,
cool. I didn't have any ideas. I was just curious because, like, I figure that'll come up in the future.
Weevil. You notice as you look over to these 2 men grappling each other as the wife's on the floor, like, stop it, stop fighting, boys, freaked out, kind of just panicking at this point, still on the floor. As Roadie, Candy's henchman, is grappling with this pajamaed man, the pajamas man's feet suddenly give out from underneath him as if something is yanking them back violently, and he slides across the floor for a second as Roadie kind of steps into the hatch, now freed from the grapple, and he looks at you, Weevil, and just mumbles through his stoma to close the hatch.
I
dude, we gotta go.
Yeah, Weevil like freezes for a second, and like the
as LED you freeze, face, you feel the hatch yanked closed. Not through your servos and not through your servos and your own will. Something else pulls it closed.
Oh god, and Weevil kind of like, I'm assuming like he's been leaning over the control pad because he's in the middle and kind of in the back, so like he is like he like thunk against the back side of the wall as like the door kind of forces him closed and back into his seat, and he looks around like, did anyone else see what that was? What was that? What was that?
Did I see?
And
he's like, that was fate. That's what it was. And Candy will kick his feet up on whatever he can, even if that's another bird.
Candy doesn't have any room to kick his feet up anywhere except the central console. And as his heel, glamorous and glittered and everything in all of its glory, collides with the console, he accidentally hits the launch button. And the pod jolts away from the main ship and launches off into space.
Oh man, fuck you, Candy Sweet Star.
That was very like cinematic.
It really is. God, yeah.
I'm imagining the door that closed to this thing has like a window.
Yes. It's got a porthole.
I'm looking back to like the other sided window to see what happened to the people that we just left.
They're fine. Like the escape pod doesn't like depressurize the cabin and they're sucked out into space, but they're just like looking. The man manages to get up. He helps his wife up and they look out to you and in half embrace, looking through their own version of the window as their last hope, flies away from them. They look worried.
We already killed somebody.
Well, not you, Candy. Just Weevil, to be fair to you guys, it's specifically Candy because Candy is not a good guy.
Weevil holds up a hand in a wave and then puts the other hand up on his heart. But little known to you guys, he's actually covering his like eyes / camera. He's not watching them fade into the good night. That fucking sucks.
Yeah. Sorry. Didn't really know you, though.
Jenko just kind of glares at Candy, just disgusted and kind of horrified.
I mean, I would have fought for my life, too, I think.
Yeah, if Candy will notice Jenko's look of contempt, he'll call him out for it. Like,
yeah,
what did you expect me to do? Just sit there and die?
No, we could have brought one of them on. I could have been like chest pack.
We could have all died, and what? The universe would have lost its shining star. Don't you understand that?
I don't know if that's a big
the benefit of mankind.
Look around you. Look at all the people in this little escape pod. What's everybody here good at? You supposedly sing. I heard you singing. I tried to drown it out with actual music.
Damn!
At this point, the Thraxon is just sitting. The Thraxon is sitting in the background, just kind of very quietly whispering to the people to his left and right, Weevil and Kali. He's just like, oh shit. Oh damn. These guys gives each other a zinger.
Candy is gonna. He's gonna try and almost like lunge for him and like fight him because like this is one of the few people that is actually smaller than Candy, but of course Candy is not strong enough to even fight against the belt that's holding him back. So he's gonna swing at the air a little bit. Roadie, will you attack him, please? And he's gonna ask Roadie to hurt him somehow.
Okay.
Roadie,
guys, wait. Not. Collie's gonna interject. Be like, guys, look, I get it. Can we like wait until we're not 6 inches from each other? As guys, I can smell your breath.
You're welcome.
I know you really liked those breath mints they were serving at the bar, Candy. I saw you.
Yeah, they were actually. Whiskey infused.
I have run a diagnostic on him, and it seems that he has only had 1.5 calories in the last 24 hours. I doubt he has had breath mints.
That's true. We wouldn't even eat the cucumber.
You know? As you guys are sort of coming to a head, tensions coming to a boil, Candy is trying to get his henchmen to commit a murder in a small confined space. Things begin to calm back down as Collie and Weevil diffuse the situation to a degree. And as everybody kind of takes a breath for a quick second, the tension still kind of simmering in the background. There is a sudden jolt as something large and hard collides with your escape pod. As you all begin to spin wildly out of control, your seat belts barely keeping you buckled to your seats as your centers of gravity are wanting to fly upward and just bounce you around the interior of this thing. Red lights again begin to flash as a familiar scene takes over, as alarms blare, red lights flash, and you guys are brought into a world of chaos once again, only a few minutes after your last world of chaos was left behind. Luckily, this one doesn't last for very long, and there's not much you can do about it in the interim, as I'm sure Kali goes to punch at the controls a little bit to see if he can regain control of this thing. Candy yells at Roadie to do something to fix this situation. Weevil runs diagnostics the best he can from the interior, and Janko looks for anything mechanical he can fix. The sum all be all answer to all of these potential routes of action are no, you're fucked. As after about 15 minutes of this nauseating, alarm deafening spinning, you all collide in a deafening, earth shattering crash as you temporarily, I think, all black out. And after an indeterminate amount of time, you wake back up in the smoldering remains of your escape pod, with sunlight filling the one window available to you. Pieces of the escape pod kind of fractured and broken off, with small windows and streams of sunlight pouring through them. A very warm, radiant heat joins these open paneled sections of the escape pod as well. As you all come to in various states of bruised and batteredness and disarray, groggy, buckled in various uncomfortable positions with seatbelts grinding up on your collarbones and necks and various areas. But everybody's alive and well enough. As you guys are now surface side, presumably on Saragon 2. The wrong planet.
Right.
Which at this point I will give you in detail.
I thought this was the right planet for me.
No, you want to go to Saragon 3.
Oh.
Everybody wants to go to Saragon 3.
Oh.
Saragon 2. Desert. Slightly bigger than Earth. Day lake, 30 hours. Length of year, 305 days. Temperatures range from 45 at their absolute coldest to 200 degrees Fahrenheit at their absolute warmest. Only, despite being several thousand miles wider in diameter than Earth, only a population of 30,000, primarily human and Gra'kul, in Novacore territory. Exports and imports are none, as this is a wild wasteland of a world. An overlooked portion of the Saragon system, a desert wasteland with nothing to offer but a plethora of sand and empty space to think about whatever mistakes one may have made that they've wound up on this god's forsaken rock, populated by a handful of criminals, desert hermits, and violent gangs comprised of the original settlers of Saragon 2 who were left to rot and wallow after the scream. And you guys are in a wrecked pod on the surface of it. You guys are free to move about the cabin.
Candy will, I guess, have Roadie undo his buckling and everything for him. And he'll exit the You'll exit the ship and just kind of like walk outside and just start pacing. It's like very clearly he's upset, not, you know, just because of the crash, but because of, you know, potentially like other circumstances. He's just kind of like red faced and upset, and, you know.
Great. As Candy steps out into the desert oasis before him, he is overwhelmed with a torrent of heat as the temperatures are very clearly over 100 degrees Fahrenheit at this point. The sunlight kind of beating down in the middle of the day just blinds you from the sort of the dim interior of this crashed escape pod for a brief moment before you gather your bearings and are able to freely kick sand and rocks at your discretion.
Okay. I mean, for the time being, I'm not going to do anything else because obviously this is not Candy's show.
But yeah, I wanted to sort of give you their narration of, oh, this is what happens when you get out, because it's a jarring coming out of the vault and fallout-like experience. Just, fuck, it's so hot and bright.
Is everyone all right?
I am attempting to run a diagnostic, and Weevil turns, and you see him, like, crack one of his knuckle joints is at, like, a 70-degree angle off of what it normally should be. And there's a as he like rotates it back into place and then flexes his hand and he's like functioning at 98% efficiency before he turns to the display of whatever's left of the console and begins trying to run a diagnostic on the computer of the life pod to see if there was anything that could indicate what the fuck happened to cause that.
Unfortunately, the life pods, as you begin your diagnostics, first of all, you notice that things are damaged on the this console, right? This life pod, after crashing into they have stabilizers and jets to make them land softly. They're not meant to crash into a planet's surface at absolute full force like they did. Unfortunately, something that hits you damaged the systems and the crash damaged it further, et cetera, et cetera. So the life pod is already not in full working condition anymore, heavily damaged with sections missing from the walls, as well as computer and engineering problems. And unfortunately, the life pod is its own independent system, so that if something horribly wrong goes, or something goes horribly wrong with the main ship, the life pods are not accidentally put into like override system. They are not accidentally ejected by the system's main computer. They are a completely independent system, so there won't be any diagnostics on the main ship on this life pod. Unless you were hit by space debris.
Oh, okay. Gotcha.
Either a piece of the ship or an asteroid. You're not too sure.
Yeah, Weevil turns to the pod and like punches something, and like the screen flashes for a second before it dies again. And he's like, wait a minute. And he looks up and sees the giant fucking gash in the ceiling. And he goes, I know, we were hit by space debris. And he is going to climb out after Candy as well. And you know, once he's got his bearings, he's going to try and help the rest of the survivors out. I do want to check and see, like, I am looking around, though, to see if, like, anyone has any major injuries or anything that I need to treat. Like, are any of the people with us, did any get, like, head traumas or, like, severe lacerations or anything more than just bruises?
Luckily, no. Everybody is in current working, living condition. Nobody has anything more than some scraped up arms, some bruises, and mild injuries at best.
Cool.
So the life pods are good for one thing, and protecting people inside is just that.
Hell yeah. So I'm going to help anyone out who wants out. and I'm going to say to the first person I pick up, I'm glad I did not have to help the bleach blonde one out.
The Thrax is the first to kind of take your hand, this red scale guy. He says, ah, thank you so much. And he stumbles out all dazed and confused, and he slinks against the side of the escape pod, just taking a breath and trying to gather his bearings. And you're all, you know, unless there's any reason, correct me if I'm wrong, anybody wants to fucking hang out inside the escape pod, you're all able to escort yourselves out with the help or no help of Weevil, taking his hand or passing it up.
I'll take the hand.
Yeah. Collie hops out, grabs you by the hand.
I crush it in my massive grip and I destroy your hand. No.
Janko and the military woman are able to hop out as well, emptying the escape pod and leaving you all planet side under the hot, hot desert sun. Stranded.
Does Janko or this military chick have a gun on them?
She does.
I don't. Or do I?
I don't know. I don't think you would have been carrying a gun while you were at work, unless...
I mean, if I was allowed to carry it, I feel like I would have, but if I wasn't allowed to because I'm working, I wouldn't have. I don't know what the rules are on the ship as a crew member.
I'm going to say it makes sense for Janko to have a gun on a fake underside of his toolbox so he can, like, lift up a false panel and pull his gun out kind of deal. That feels like very Janko to me. So he would have his.
Gotcha. On that same note, if it was in our... Like, I technically have a laser pistol with my starter kit. Is that something that... I mean, I feel like... For travelers, maybe there's a case to be made of, like, oh, well, I had my stuff on me because I don't have a whole lot.
You hide a gun in your arm cavity or something as a robot. Like, you can do weird shit.
Yeah, I'm going to say...
To figure out if I have all my equipment, sorry.
Is yours integrated to you? Would you like that?
I mean, why not, I guess, if it doesn't incorporate any system strain.
There you go. Yeah, you're fine. You have it on you.
But.
And everybody else woke up in their rooms, so you have your stuff.
Or lack of
it. Cool. I'm just immediately thinking Lord of the Flies is going to happen with whoever has a weapon, and we have some incompetent people on board, so.
All right, everybody stay calm, right? Like, we should be calm?
I am calm.
As you say that, Janko just yells, fuck, and just, like, turns around and just walks 10 feet away and just stands there and stares at the desert.
Probably goes to
Candy.
It does not exist in clothes. It goes to...
Candy will look at Polly the Flower. Can you just... You're the one that just said, everybody be calm, right?
Fuck yeah.
Everybody be calm. Calm. And he has like his suit is a little damaged, like he has like rips in his like perfect, you know, stage attire. How can I be calm? My life is not supposed to go this way. I am a star. I am a star. I've sold millions and millions of songs. I've done so much. Why am I here with you? Who are you? What are you? I am so much above you. And then Candy kicks the escape pod.
As Candy kicks the escape pod, you guys actually see the entire thing creak in the loose sand below. And one of those external wings on top that you see in the image I sent a minute ago actually breaks off and spears Candy through the chest.
Whoa.
Underneath its entire kind of 2-ton weight, and then creaks over and crushes his entire lower body, splatting blood out, and in a 10-foot radius, getting most of you. As you guys kind of look down, and Candy Sweetstar is definitely fucking dead. He's about some shoulders and a head.
Roadie, at this point, looking at Candy,
looking, he also covered in blood. Oh, now Rhodey rushes over and tries to see if there's anything he can do, obviously quickly realizing that Candy is dead. Rhodey puts his hands on his head. He's just pacing back and forth. Oh, no. Oh, no. And he looks at Candy's compad, and he's going to try and plug in information on his compad. Trying to open it up.
Yeah, you managed to just dig into the sand a little bit underneath where Candy's like wrist would have been, and his compad is smashed to pieces.
Oh no, goddamn! And Rhodey just starts like pacing back and forth. Finally, you're actually like hearing him for the first time. He's like just pacing back and forth, looking at this mess of blood and fucking guts. And this,
dude, you cut out.
Villain!
Oh, what a perfect time. Perfect time for this.
Damn it, I can just know he's going on.
Yeah. Well, he muted himself, so I feel like he does.
Wait, he's muted. What the fuck?
Yeah. I feel like he's sorting something out, or I don't know. Something. As Rhodey's freaking out, and you guys are all... oh, he's back. There we go.
Yeah, sorry. I ordered food, and literally, as, like, this pivotal moment that we've been planning for months happens, it's delivered, so I have to go get it.
God damn it.
Okay.
All right, but
we'll take it from the top. Rhodey dramatically turns to the rest of the party after learning that Candy's data pad is smashed and unsalvageable. And he says,
"Do you know how much money he owed me?"
All right, thank you. And that's all Rhodey says at the sight of Candy Fleet start being crushed to death.
I don't mean to change the focus here, bro, but I think he got a bit more problems than money, and Kali like readjusts his sunglasses.
Honestly, if you use
a man is fucking dead.
I feel like your life got better now that he's gone.
Hearing a robot curse is so funny.
He is reduced to what I would refer to as a fine red slurry.
Giblets.
Whoosh. All right. Look. So his phone didn't work. I mean, mine does. Can I check if my phone or my compad thing has service?
It absolutely, you're right. So the way, for what it's worth, just to establish this, because I think I did it for some of you and not others, the way interstellar kind of service, telephone calls, internet works in this sector is when you're in Micross and Novacorp space in particular, they have a well-established networks of satellites, and they have kind of a post office-like system to send messages between star systems. So within a star system, you have satellites that should allow you to communicate with people on Saragon 3 from Saragon 2, provided that there is the physical infrastructure, i.e. satellites orbiting Saragon 2, to carry your message, then shoot it over to satellites orbiting Saragon 3, and then shoot it back down, right? Simple enough. In order to get a message to a different system, you would need basically to physically deliver the message, deliver the data. So what you could normally do is you could go to this sort of post office-like service, the sort of interstellar message delivery service, the IMDS, and you pay them a small fee, like 5 credits. It's actually, I think it's 2 credits per jump they'll have to make. So if it's just one system over, it's 2 credits. You record your message, or you send your text, or you record your video, whatever it is. They'll jump it over, and then they'll use the satellites to get it where it needs to go. That being said, as you check your compads now, Saragon 2 being a dump of a planet that Novacorp has all but ignored, there are no satellites, there is no infrastructure, you do not have signal on this planet.
All right, we might have a nice solid issue. Kali wants to like scan the horizon and be like, you think anyone random is pulled up here? I think I saw a movie about this once. Some guy named Obi Flan could.
Only Flan cannoli.
Yeah. Yeah. An Italian man.
The red Thrax looks at Kali as he's clearly having a heat stroke already, making things up about strange Flan man. Kali looks at the horizon, and you see a number of potentially notable landmarks. First you see dunes, and then there's some dunes, and then you look around and you see some more dunes. But beyond those dunes, to the west, you see there's a craggy, rocky mountain range. You see to the north is a very large plume of smoke, like a monstrously large plume of smoke. As you all kind of are able to clock this, it's not very discreet. You gather that's maybe, likely, either some sort of wild forest fire, which wouldn't really make sense on a desert planet, or it is all but likely it is probably the wreckage of the main portion of the ship. You also see a small plume of smoke pretty far to the south, maybe some sort of campfire, maybe another forest fire, again, probably not, maybe another sort of plume of smoke from another escape pod or a piece of breakage from the ship, or maybe it's just something else entirely, who knows. It's too small to be anything major, though. And those are kind of like the sort of three landmarks you can kind of see. The east is mostly just more dunes, just landscape on landscape.
Gotcha. Okay.
Connor, Weevil, you get an internal ding as coordinates begin to file in one after the other. Giving a sort of optimized path to the source of the cause of this sort of signal that is being output to you. And it is, you gather, at least for the most part, pointing towards that small beacon to the south, or a small plume of smoke to the south, rather.
Okay. So is the ding something everyone can hear, or is that just Weevil?
I think it's your choice.
Okay, I think you would hear
seems a, like an internal,
and then
system.
You would see his LED display turn back to that spinning icon for a second, and then back to the little smiling face. And he goes,
"I believe I have gotten some form of reception. I think we should head in that direction."
And he points to the smaller beacon of smoke.
Why? What's over there? Did you just say
what is over there, dude?
That's what I heard.
Yeah, I heard too.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what I said. What about it?
I am not exactly sure, but I believe it may be some form of civilization.
Civilization out here? I doubt it. It's probably fucking psychos. What if we go to the big plume? Establish what we came from the ship, maybe try to establish contact with somebody.
Jenko, as you say that, not only is that a very plausible form of action, you recognize, but you recognize that you would know this. The escape pod that you were in, despite being damaged and broken, they are all equipped with outgoing distress beacons. So you could potentially, if you could manage to jury-rig this thing and fix it up, you could potentially project a distress beacon from your location and hopefully wait for rescue. Although, of course, you know, and if you level this, you're sure it's to be brought up by, if not you, then somebody else. Who knows how long until escape comes, or who comes. Or rescue comes, right. On escape, Jesus. But yeah, anyway, you know that these things are retrofitted with distress beacons as well. So you could, along with going to the main ship, try and repair this or investigate Weevil's things, or Weevil's hunch. Or other courses of action. I just wanted to point out the escape distress beacon thing because...
All right, I feel like before we go marching into the endless waste to be done in, like... our celebrity friend. I want to try to troubleshoot a way out of this with our escape pod, which is literally designed to help people survive shit. Right. So give me a sec. I'm gonna go in there. I'm gonna try to set up some kind of contact or send a signal.
Oh, dude, you're gonna go in the machine that just turned candy into. Well, that.
Yeah. Well, one. It's no. It's nothing of value was lost. Two. it was the exterior that killed him. Yeah. The interior probably still works.
I mean, all right, just don't kick anything, I guess.
I'm not. All right, I'm gonna just go in there and just see if I can plug in what I need to send a message, like an SOS.
Sure. Unfortunately, yeah, you get in there and you start poking around. Overtly obvious, the sender control panel. It's damaged, right? It got hurt in the fall. It got hurt when you got collided. Outgoing nav beacon systems are fucked. You're going to have to do some minor programming on the interior, and then you're probably going to have to climb up on top of this thing to physically fix the distress beacon portion of it to get the antenna signal going out, you gather. As you're in there and examining this, running your diagnostics, essentially, you plug in your data pad into this thing, you run a full scan on it, see, all right, what the fuck's wrong with this thing? The military lady kind of leans in, and she's like, you know, if you put a distress beacon out, who knows who's going to answer? You sure you want to put a big... Hey, we're out here, stranded. Signal to whoever might be listening. Huh, little fella?
I mean, now that you mention it, no, I'm not sure. But I also know that our chances of surviving increase if we meet anybody. Like, versus just the heat. You know? Like, we could barter or we could pretend to submit to some asshole that wants to take advantage of us. There's so many ways you could do it, but if we're just alone out here for long enough, we're still dead.
Hey, I'm not gonna stand in your way, but I'd take a heat stroke over cannibals any day. And she kind of bangs on the side of the door and turns back around and leaves.
She gets
Roadie, going off of what he said, he'll say, you do look like you'd be good at submitting. I like your idea about going to the big ship, though. And just points over to the big plume of smoke. If there's anybody out here, probably gonna be eating each other. That's my guess, anyway.
Wait, is that a thing? Is that what people do here?
I mean, that's my guess.
Is that a fact? Or is that just like gestures of the world? I don't know, racism?
I do not see any produce around. If you see a carrot, tell me.
You know, you're getting a little lippy.
I have no lips.
There's another, not you. There's another wing up there. I might be able to break that off and squish you if you don't keep your shit in check.
Can we use the wing as like a Final Fantasy weapon?
No, it's like 2 tons.
maybe Weevil could.
No.
No, Weevil has 2 hit points.
Weevil has like 12 strength at best, probably lower.
Yeah.
God.
The only thing I can do that you can't is not die in a vacuum.
I can't believe one of the beefiest characters we have is a fucking guy in jorts who serves.
And he can't do either. He can't do that right now.
Yeah. We're the waves.
I think we should head over those mountains so we can at least get some shade.
All right, let's get shade. Let's go to the big... ship wreckage, but first, yeah. I think we should just vote. Do you want to send a distress signal and risk cannibals and or help, or do you want to just
it's not racist if you say risk cannibals, but I say that there might be cannibals out here, and I'm the racist.
All right, Kid Rock, calm down.
I mean, technically,
I don't know who that is.
When you're the majority species, your potential to be racist is better, but if you're a minority, it's just technically prejudiced, but yeah.
I want you to know, sincerely, I do not like you.
I want you to know, sincerely, if you can help us all out here, I don't care. I don't mind that.
Okay.
he scoops down and eats a handful of sand.
Are we going to vote on the signal, or are we just not going to do that?
Look, I think it couldn't hurt to, like, send off the signal and then leave the ship and watch from afar. Hey, Weevil, do you have any, like, binoculars or something in that noggin of yours?
I mean...
I don't know, maybe you have some, like, robots.
Yeah, here. Yeah. Weevil turns away from you and he goes,
yes, give me one moment.
And you hear as his, like, hands are up near his face, and he turns around and his hands are cupped around his, like, little LED eyes, and he goes,
this is about as useful as I can be. Do it yourself. I have no binoculars.
Yeah. Binoculars activated.
Yeah. Literally, he's cupped his hands around his eyes. And he's, you know, he does have a camera. He can zoom in and out, but it's like literally, I imagine it's no better than normal eyes. Like
it's like a phone camera, basically.
Yeah, literally, you zoom in, you can maybe make out a couple more things specifically, but it's much, it gets grainy, you know, like it's for all intents and purposes the same as just blowing up a low res image.
Fuck.
Yeah, so,
Well, look, we can at least, like, set off the signal, walk away, just to see if there are actual people out here, you know?
If there are cannibals, I believe that they probably would not have the ability to read and or write. Perhaps if we leave and write, gone in this direction, survivors of Isabella, and make an arrow, that would indicate to other survivors or possible rescue parties where we have gone.
I don't know why they'd be illiterate, but it might make sense.
I feel like they might be.
Yeah, now who's the racist?
Then again, the rock. Alex and the rock. Alex and the rock.
I have no idea. Okay, between Dylan's burping and Connor laughing, I have no idea what you said, Nick.
Are the rocks kind of a vantage point?
Yeah, they're giant, craggy, rocky mountains, but they also are in not the opposite direction of each plume of smoke, but they're to the west and the other ones are to the north and south. So you'd be going, like, well out of your way to get to this mountain range. To get a vantage point on potentially both plumes of smoke if you had either really good vision, clear weather, or some sort of binoculars.
I don't know, guys. Seems like the only guaranteed safety here, or at least guaranteed shade, is this pillar, this rock mountain. Because if we go to another down ship, it might just be that. A down ship with a bunch of dead people in it. And
it's we'd
be
stuck. I just had an idea.
Well, we ain't planning on flying it out of here. It's to use our systems to call out a signal or something.
But why would it be any different than ours?
I had an idea. Hold up.
Ours doesn't work.
I feel like any sentient life on this rock is going to be just curiously moving toward that shipwreck. So what if we move to a position between that campfire and the shipwreck, and we watch who's going towards the shipwreck?
So what I am hearing is that out of the obvious points of interest, you want us to go to none.
Yes, the middle.
Here's an idea. Why don't we all sit in a circle and talk about it for a month while we starve to death?
How about make it?
I am not serving.
Well, the military woman.
Roadkill.
The military lady kicks rocks for a moment. And she goes, "We're not going to starve to death. We're going to die of heat stroke and dehydration way before that. And she kind of looks at the rest of you. That or we'll start killing each other in a couple of hours.
I believe the latter is more likely.
Me too.
Jenko looks at her gun and looks at everyone else's, like, equipment and just analyzes who's the threat.
All right. Everybody here who wants to go to the mountain, say, or at least hold up your hand. And Ollie holds up his hand.
All right, fuck it. Let's go to the mountain to get a perspective. Yeah, I agree.
So the mountain is to the
west.
Other things are north and south.
Kits.
Here's another idea. If anyone would like to go to the active beacon, raise your hand.
Real quick. Kits will raise his hand. The red scaled Thraxon will raise his hand to go to the mountains as well. And you want to go. the military woman will raise her hand to go to the beacon with Weevil.
Okay, so that's 3 for the mountain.
2 for the beacon so far.
Yeah.
That leaves, I think, Roadie to either be a tiebreaker or to vote to go to somewhere else. Not a tiebreaker, but either.
If we can go to the ship afterwards. There's stuff there that I want to get.
Okay, so that's 4 for the mountain.
Yeah.
Alright.
Hell six.
Let's get walking.
Besides, the sun, see, Alex, is it, what time? I know I don't know what time it is, but, like, where's the sun in the sky?
High noon.
It's high noon!
It's pretty directly above. Yeah, you guys don't want to be out here for too much longer.
And I know you gave us all this information, but I doubt Holly would know this off the top of his head. It's like, I don't know how long days are on this planet, but the second that sun goes down, we might freeze to death. Especially because I'm, you know, not really prepared for this kind of cold weather. Right now, I'm chilling, but I think let's start heading to the mountain.
Okay. You know, just to seal the loop on it, can you stop burping into the microphone? Thraxen will kind of pipe up and say, as he's like mushing his fingers together, and he's like, so that's a no on setting the beacon out before we leave. I'd like to be rescued personally.
I don't think it could hurt.
Let's put the beacon on first, then go to the mountain.
Yeah.
That's what I prefer.
I'm okay with that.
So again, Janko, you know that as you examine the interior of this thing, you know that the exterior antenna is damaged. You'll need to get up there and manually fix that with some sort of hardware engineering. And the interior systems are damaged as well. You'll need to do some minor programming to sort of bypass sort of reroute the remaining power into the distress beacon from the other life support systems that are being currently kept online. So you'll need to do a little bit of programming and a little bit of fixing to get this running.
I'm going to ask, is anybody good at programming? I'm good. Understand. But, all right, you. I bet you would be. Cool. Can you go in?
Was that racist? I am not aware.
Oh, no, it was just me observing your, you know, usefulness.
My mechanical and artificial origins, I understand. Okay.
All right, I'm going to try to set up the antenna on the exterior. If you can go back inside and look at the software systems and get them in tip-top shape.
Yeah, Weevil will do his best not to slip on the blood of Candy or just fucking squish him any further than he already has been. And we'll clamber back inside and hunker down near the display and try and, like, poke at it, interface with it, connect, like, you know, take out the port in his wrist and see if he can get any life while Janko fiddles with the mechanical side of things.
All right. Is it a fixed check or what do I
have to do? Yeah. So before I give a description on what happens, I'll need Weevil to make a program intelligence and Janko to make a fix intelligence.
Cool. I will stick with that program intelligence because that sounds good to me.
It's a 9 for the fix and an 11 for the program. Oh, wow, yeah. You guys are pretty quickly able to make this, short work of this, essentially, as Janko with his rodent-like body scrambles up the side of this life pod, getting to the top to sort of bust out his toolkit. I don't know what you have on your character sheet. Do you have, like, a multi-tool or anything like that?
I've got,
as far as like your, just anything that you use to fix this, just so I can, for narration purposes.
I have a meta tool, a monoblade, post tech toolkit, air parts.
Yeah, good. Cool. So you got a meta tool and a toolkit. Sick. You are able to easily kind of pull out the mini blowtorch, the soldering gun, the wrenches, the the crowbars and straighten up what needs to be straightened, weld together what seems to be broken, use a couple of spare wires to reconnect circuits, and you know, get this thing tip-top shape for the most part. Within just a matter of 5 to 10 minutes, Weevil, your work is a lot easier on the interior, as you are able to just use your internal wrist port to jack into this thing and very quickly sort of overwrite some software that says power goes here and power goes here, and you're like, no, it doesn't, it all goes here, and you redirect everything to a single focus point by switching some ones and zeros around, easy enough, and it's all now going to the distress beacon. And Janko, as soon as you put the last piece in place, the tip of the beacon on top of this escape pod begins to glow red, pulsing ever so slowly, and you know that means it's outputting this distress signal.
Yes. I while I'm fiddling around in there before like this starts, can I encode our names into the beacon and just say like W3VIL Roadie Roadkill or whatever his name is, Roadie Roadster, I believe. Maybe I'll get it on a third try if that was wrong. I don't.
it's Roadie Roadkill.
Roadie Roadkill, hell yeah. And then, you know, Jenko, I just want to put our names in that as well.
With an 11, yeah, you could add, instead of like a standard, you know, basic kind of blanket message, there's this almost like Morse code that is trailed after it. So anybody tuning in will get like, this is an automated distress beacon from, and then just like boop, 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 boop. And if they're, you know, proficient in any sort of piloting or whatever, they'll know what it means.
Cool. Yep.
Sick. The distress beacon is now going. Janko is able to demount the escape pod. Weevil is able to climb out of it.
Not before. Just one detail thing. I had to mute myself for a second, but you were inputting the survivors, right?
Yes.
Roadie will tell you to put Candy as a survivor. And not just me.
Okay. Before he, like, I mean, I'm not going to fight you on it, but...
That would be dishonest. Why would we do that? He is very clearly a pile of flesh and bones.
I don't know. Maybe we can bring him back.
that would be medically impossible, but I don't very know well. This,
well, see, there are people out there that would be my boss, and Candy, they'd probably send somebody to come and pick up. Me, maybe not so much. That's why.
He makes a decent point.
I mean, he said it himself. He's a singer to the stars or some dumb bullshit.
So you Mars didn't know dumb bullshit. Very well.
And Weevil turns back to the console and then fills out the
whatever.
Was anyone here honestly like a fan of his music?
I thought he was a little blasé.
Dude, he sucked.
I feel like we're the only people in this entire sector. This is a boat filled with people who recognize Candy Sweetstar.
The military dressed woman goes, well, you know who was a fan of his? That lady he threw against the wall earlier and took her seat. She loved him.
Sure did.
I wonder if she'd, like, be alive right now.
Yeah.
I mean, based on the fact that we all are, I doubt she would have kicked this in anger.
I mean, when you think about it, the two biggest fans of Candy were that lady and Candy. And look what happened to both of them. Looks like being a fan doesn't pay off, does it?
Suppose not.
Yes, that is fair.
So, Roadie, you weren't a fan of his? He just owed you a bunch of money for helping him?
Pretty much. He owed me a bunch of money. And the person above us owes me a bunch of money. And, well,
I gotta protect him if I want to get paid, so... You know?
I can respect that. I get it, it's cool.
I will say I did not like the man very much. Never did.
Did he pay well?
No.
Damn.
Roadie will laugh.
Damn. Ah, well.
Hey, are we done talking about this red smear, or should we get going?
Yes, I believe, as the old Westerns would say, get along, little doggy.
Polly eyes that bitch.
Also, what is this woman's name? I don't think she's told us.
No, you know, don't bother. Nobody's asked.
I was putting names in, so Weevil would have gone, and your name?
At what point? Oh, during this. Yeah. She's like, nobody's going to come looking for me. You put Sarah Lockhart.
All right. Okay, damn, that's fucking cool character art.
More like sock fart, hey-o.
I crush Collie's windpipe with a massive metal hand.
Do you have any drinks or drugs on you, perchance?
What is that supposed to mean?
That I'd like to partake?
No, I do not have any drugs.
I got some fruit snacks.
You leave those in the sun long enough, they might turn into drugs.
You got a good point, I guess.
Actually, perhaps they will find some mushrooms that could be converted into medicinal hallucinogenics.
As a gesture of goodwill, Janko's going to offer some fruit snacks that are kind of melty to Roadie.
Yeah. Roadie will take a fruit snack. He actually has not eaten at all in a little bit. I had a pretty shitty dinner.
I'd like to express that we're walking to the mountains while talking about this.
Yes, yeah. You guys begin the long hike towards these mountains to I don't know your plan at this full point. Obviously, you want some shade, but it's like, at what point do you decide enough is enough? You know, so I guess you'll discuss when you get there or on your way there. You know what? As you walk, you guys make some small talk, some conversation. Number one that they're gonna somebody's gonna bring up is Sarah's gonna sort of walking towards the front of the group. Will be like, so what's the plan once we get to these mountains? There'll be some relief from the shade. Maybe we can find some sort of shelter, a cave or something. How long do we hunker it out? Wait till nightfall and investigate while it's cooler, or?
Well, I think it's going to get a little too cold at night. It might be smart to take like a half nap and explore during like dawn or dusk, but I was thinking before we charge headlong into racist cannibals, we take a peek at what's going on over there, and we see what's happening at these rocks. Maybe civilization could be over here. We won't melt to death. I can put on some sunscreen.
I believe you are onto something. It seems prudent to travel primarily at dawn and dusk. I do not know what the lowest possible temperature on this planet is, but I doubt it is sustainable to human life.
I feel like traveling at night would still be safer than traveling during the day, regardless. I'd rather be chilly and not burning to death. All of us except the wizard, I think, have hot blood, so we keep it hot by moving, you know, at night. So.
Hey, I'm called a Straxon, all right? I'm not just a lizard. Netza.
Sorry. You're right. People call me a bat all the time, and I kind of am, but I'm not. I get it. I'm sorry.
Yeah. And just because just because I have reptilian features doesn't mean I like it out here in the extreme heat, all right? I'm sweating in this thing.
As he's like pulling at the collar of his vac suit. His name is Kitz.
We're on the same page.
As you begin to walk as well, let me look at Why do you have... Okay. Does anybody have one of these? I'm just looking through your equipment real quick to see if anything flags.
No. I have money.
Yeah, fucking you picked money. Everybody else picked these, like, interesting whatevers, and you're like, I want money.
Can I add, like, a surfboard?
I don't think you brought the surfboard with you, if you had one. No, you don't have one, and I fucking doubt Roadie has one. Yeah, no. Shoe knife. Alright, yeah, you guys are walking. And, I think initially I'm gonna need everybody to make me a physical save.
Ooh. Saving throws, physical...
Oh, Weevil, you're fine, actually. You don't need to make one.
Oh, hell yeah, baby. Already paying off being a robot.
Money. Oh, baby, let's go.
She's going to roll one. Ooh, not 24.
All that time out on the beach, it worked. Also, change candy to Roadie. His candy is jello.
sick. Weevil doesn't need to roll. Kali gets a perfect 15 out of 15. 16 over versus 14 and 18. Oh, wow, you guys are good. And Kitz doesn't need to roll one because of his back suit, and Sarah gets a nat 20. So everybody passes. You guys are solid desert explorers. You guys will live forever.
Until you're invincible!
Yeah. As you guys walk, the heat bears down on you, and... the occasional small bird flies by, tumbleweed drifts over, a sand gust whips into your faces. I'm trying to think of a fair way to ask for this without everybody giving me a check, because I just want one check. Can you guys nominate somebody to give me a notice wisdom check?
I nominate Nick.
A notice wisdom check?
Yeah, I don't just want like a group roll. But
seems like a very Nick roll to make you.
You think? All right.
Yeah, it starts with an N.
Yeah, exactly.
And Nick notices.
So Kali takes the notice wisdom. Sure, he'll be leading the crowd. I'll take it. Big money.
He did want to use you like binoculars, so I guess I'll check that.
No. Wait, Alex, if I want to use my expert thing, do I get to know if...
I'll tell you, yeah, that's not good enough. Seven's not good enough.
Oh, it says once per scene you can reroll the failed skill check, so can I try it again?
Yeah.
Money!
Mildly better, from a 7 to a 9.
Whoa!
That does push you past the... It pushes you past the 8 threshold, at least. Which is enough to get at least this, where as you guys are walking, Kali, you're probably, I imagine, it's kind of towards the middle of the pack, just hanging out, drifting around, shooting shit with everybody, making small talk. You guys are getting to know each other along this long walk. And Kali, you just feel like you hear from, like, behind you, back the way you came. Not directly behind you, like, oh, the escape pod blew up. That's what it is. But, like, from the general 180 arc behind you, an echoey kind of bouncing around the desert landscape, kind of just like a very quiet revving that is being echoed across a large distance of some sort of motor vehicle. Kind of like a, you know, like a, you know, but just... the reverberations of it.
Is it adorned with spikes and a guitar stuff?
No, you don't see it, and you barely hear it.
Can I hear guitar music playing?
No.
Can you hear the spikes?
Yeah, you feel like you hear like one long and then it just kind of fades out and disappears.
Huh. Oh.
It's not heading towards you. It's not visible. You look around, so, you just don't see anything.
Yo, dude, did anyone else, like, hear that?
No.
I don't think we did.
The only thing I hear is the sound of sand.
Was my roll good enough to know what direction it came from?
Behind you in a 180 degree arc, so that's about as good as you get.
Can I see like a plume of smoke or
sand no. coming from the There's no more details with a nine. That's what you hear, yeah.
I don't know, maybe I was imagining something. Let's keep going.
You see a Morten Jim on top.
Is there a man named Sam? Or Max?
And is he mad?
Mad Sam.
Angry Bill.
The salty Sam.
All right. Yeah.
I say, does anyone hear that? But I don't do anything else.
And as you continue onwards towards the mountains ahead of you, the music has stopped. I've noticed. It stopped a while ago, probably.
Oh, fuck. Today was the day the music died. Candy was right.
Oh, shit.
Told you.
And music.
You guys are able to encroach upon the base of the mountains. This large sort of outstretched kind of craggy range of spiked mountains, some pointed, some rounded at the top, cast a large shadow before you, immediately cooling you to a small degree as you enter their sort of looming presence. They're made out of some sort of hard limestone, sandstone mixture. Looks like they're vaguely climbable, though it would be incredibly dangerous without climbing gear. And you're immediately able to pick out a few small kind of caves in the sides of these things that you could potentially nestle up in, seek shelter within, as well as some divots in between some of the mountainous peaks that you could potentially work your way up towards to get some more exposed, yet still better than open air cover if you didn't want to hide into one of the caves.
So, I have a question. Have we seen any form of plant life?
Outside of like some dried shrubs that are half dead and wouldn't provide any nourishment and don't contain much water, no.
Okay.
I believe it may be prudent to begin collecting some form of kindling or firewood, because while I may not need heat, I believe the inverse is true for all of you. If we are going to be entering into the cave and hoping to survive more than a few hours at night, it may be important to have a source of heat.
Ollie like wags a finger at Weevil and goes, I think that's a good idea. I don't really want to freeze to death. I know traveling at night might be a little bit more comfortable, but I've heard deserts get
pretty cold. Not if it's freezing temperatures.
Exactly. So I think getting some firewood and hunkering down in one of these caves might be a pretty good idea. I also keep noticing that my voice sometimes goes from surfer dude to like cowboy,
and I'm gonna. No, you're figuring it out.
A little bit of a good idea.
You're getting. It's all right. You're feeling it out.
Yeah, it's high noon.
Yeah. Get along, it's little doggy.
It takes us a little bit to get the voice down.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, easy enough. You guys are gonna be able to, if you guys are want to follow Weevil's suggestion. You can easily gather a few essentially dried shrubs, which are mostly twigs anyway, and those would make for some solid kindling. I think feel free to add those to your inventory if you're taking any. I'm going to say they're plentiful enough that you can take as many as you want to carry. You just have to be cognizant of your inventories. This is a big thing in this game. Armor usually counts towards encumbrance unless it's like padded suits or whatever. but like I'm looking at Brody, your character sheet right now. You have things marked as encumbrance, but your readied is at zero and your stowed is at zero. So I think those need to be, I don't know if there's, I think those need to be manually changed.
Okay, I will say the
pistol... Oh, you have to mark them as readied or stowed with, they're all okay. Marked as other right now.
Yeah. So I don't actually have the pistol on me. That's part of, that's something I want to get. But I will.
Okay, so you can keep that as other then.
Yeah.
You don't have.
Oh, okay.
Because if you put it as stowed, it means it's in a backpack, for your power cell. Why is encumbrance 8? That doesn't sound right. Oh, it's bundled. That's why. Cool. Sick. But yeah, make sure you guys mark your equipment as readied and stowed on your inventory sheets. Same with your armor as well, just so you know where you're at. And you can bundle 4 bushels for 1 encumbrance. They're 1 encumbrance each, but you can bundle them in groups of 4. So feel free to add as many bushels of twigs as you'd like, keeping in mind you can only carry so much.
All right, should we just add that under other equipment, or...?
You should be able to manually add things. Like, if you turn on edit mode on your character sheet, you'll be able to manually just type something in.
Oh, okay, I see.
You said add at the bottom, and then...
And you said 1 encumbrance each?
Yeah. But then you can check, I believe, the bundled option, and it'll bundle, I think, 4 of them together.
Okay, so under, like gear...
Yep.
What if you have more than your max ready and stowed? Like, what happens?
You get encumbrance, and I believe you get your movement starts to reduce. This is where I highly suggest you guys read the first 50 pages of the book. It has, like, almost all of the rules you need. Pulling it up right now. Your movement begins to, it's like for every 2 extra items, your movement begins to slow and shit like that. It's kind of specific. Character advancement, hacking, complications.
So is everything required to be either ready?
It's ready or stowed. Yeah. If it's other, that means it's somehow in your butthole. So it's floating. In a void. Yeah. Okay. Red stowed means it's in a backpack, or otherwise you're gonna have to use an action to get to it in combat. And readied means it's maybe a pistol in a holster, it is something on your hip, like a tool belt. You'll be able to access that at will, essentially. Scenes and durations. Fuck, man, where is it? I don't even know. Types of actions, rounds and initiative, hitting an enemy, common actions, injury, death, healing, execution attacks, movement, disarming, 2 weapon fighting, data protocols, physical hacking, character advancement, environmental hazards. Combat sequence, healing, equipment and vehicles. I think for the time being, it's just you can carry up to 2 more readied and 2 more stowed items at the cost of minus 10 feet of movement, and you will be able to carry another additional 2 of each for, you know, taking your movement down to 10 feet instead of 30 feet. But then after that, you're too overburdened and you just can't move. That's the baseline. There might be something else with it, like minus 2 evasion saves, but I fucking don't see it in here right now. So, that's the gist. Okay. You guys gather some kindling on your walk. Is the plan to stay in a cave, or a crux in between 2 mountains, or climb to the top of the mountains? or...
Yeah, I vaguely... well, maybe I shouldn't say that because it's a little meta. But if we're going to stay in a cave, we should...
we should probably make sure that there's nothing else staying in there.
I agree.
Like space tigers or something.
All right.
Yeah, very good point.
Can we scout the back of the cave and see if there's any like tunnels that lead into like some hellish worm pit with like monsters or anything?
Or space tigers.
Mm-hmm. So you guys decided to make residence in a cave for the time being, wandering up to the mouth of one of the lower ones, so you don't have to clamber up too much. You don't have to take any exceedingly difficult routes to get to safety. You do a minor bit of rock climbing, a minor bit of hiking, get up about 50, 60 feet off the ground into a low cave. It starts pretty small with about a 4 feet opening, 4 foot tall, about 8 feet wide, and then widens out pretty big when you get in there. Why don't, Janko, you're the one who asked, why don't you give me a notice wisdom, or I think survive would be a fair one as well. You peer around the cave, and it is, vaguely, empty. There's not a lot of signs of, definitely nothing, like, civilized in here. There's no cave paintings or torches or anything like that. You do notice, at one point, towards the back of the cave, there seems to be a large pile of brush kind of swept up along the back end of the cave. With your six, you're not sure if this is an animal nest or if this is just brush blown in naturally from the mouth of the cave to the back of the cave, because the pathway is kind of straight. So it's like, it could be.
All right. You know. It's kind of suspicious because it doesn't look supernatural, but shelter is shelter. So I believe we're not going to leave. If we're going to do watches, somebody needs to look out for something that might be coming back here to rest in whatever that was, that pile of debris. I'm mostly okay with this.
I wonder if it may be a good idea to check other options. I do not like the idea of being torn apart by, say, space tigers.
The one thing that I will say,
what if we find like a rock shelf somewhere else? It's like not a full cave, but like shelter from the sun. Is that what you're saying?
Just do a little bit of exploring. Yeah, is basically what I'm saying. Because like we know this is an option. But, like,
part of the advantage of coming to these mountains, as I see it, is to gain a lookout over the landscape. And I believe if we get higher, then we may be able to see further out.
I mean, we did come here to, like, look at the other wreckages, you know?
I thought we came here to...
Well, it's a multitask system.
Okay, wait, what time is it right now in the day, Alex? Is it day or night?
Early afternoon. It only took you a couple hours to get out here.
All right, let's not hunker down yet. Let's actually go to the top of this mountain and get a good view of where we are first.
You're nice moving up, yeah.
So these mountains are pretty. These mountains are pretty sheer, right? There's not a lot of convenient hiking paths, and you guys do not have hiking equipment, so it's not impossible. I'm not saying you can't do it. You very much can. I'm just saying there's a very real risk that somebody may fall off 80 feet up. If you were trying to get to the top, there's like a realistic amount that you can climb these mountains. You can kind of ramshackle, fucking scramble your way up a certain portion. And you get on a big rock and you're like, oh, like I'm 100 feet up and I scramble my way up here. But that's only going to be like a third of the mountain. To get up beyond, you're like, oh, let's get to the top of the mountain. You're going to be climbing, like, you're going to be bouldering at a certain point. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if we should be free soloing. I think 100 feet up is probably sufficient.
Right, but if we don't get like a full 360, we're missing half of our view of where we are.
We are also missing half of our life pod. But beggars can't be choosers.
Our life pod killed someone.
Fair point. But yeah, I mean, I say we go up as far as we can, and well,
I say we go up as far as we can and get as good of a vantage point, and then hopefully we can find a more secure rock ledge without a nest or pile of brush or whatever that may be.
Yeah, let's try and find a safer way up.
Let's go up as high as we can without bouldering, and then as soon as the path like ends, somebody, I might just volunteer to climb up and get a good view and like,
I mean, okay, as long as you can be careful.
You really want to die by falling, don't you?
I want to do something useful so that we don't just die in our sleep assuming the best about this shitty place.
Well, yeah,
I think falling off a cliff is all too useful, so.
No, let the little guy go. He doesn't want to die in his sleep. He'll die very much awake, screaming in terror.
Alright, you know what? Yeah, that's fair, I guess. You go ahead, you climb. You kind of look like a bat, you got wings on you.
Ha ha.
I like to imagine that sounds exactly like you, Michael, but like 3 octaves higher. So it's like, ha ha!
Lord. Okay, so you guys, for lack of a better descriptive process, are able to hunker back down out of this cave, back into the heat, scorching sun, and make your way slowly and carefully wandering up kind of jagged rock face after jagged rock face, finding little platforms and small spots you can climb about 5-10 feet at a time before going across another small lip and very carefully, watch the step there, you know, that little rock edge there breaks off, you stagger back, whoa, that was a close call, you climb up a different route. You get able to get about another 40 feet up off of the ground floor, and you find like a small, almost like a 45 degree acute angle, where the top of the angle is a jagged mountain peak that goes up another like 200 feet, but it also serves as an overhang of the base of the 45 degree angle, which is kind of just like a slight about 20 foot by 15 foot mostly flat kind of rounded rock lip that you guys would be able to essentially sit on, and it, because it's under this huge overhang, it's completely shaded, so it is cooler but much more exposed to the elements generally than the cave would be. And it's about, again, 100 feet off the ground floor from where you started ascending these mountains. And the peaks go up about another 200 feet, but it gets exponentially more steep and difficult to climb from here. You'll have to stop, like, hike climbing, where you're just kind of high-kneeing it up and occasionally using your hands for support. And you'll actually have to start full-body climbing, where you're using all hands and feet and knees and climbing and wedging and crimping and, you know, if you want to go any higher than this.
I don't know if I can actually climb this, man. This fall looks pretty deadly.
That is correct.
Yeah, maybe there's some way around, or like we could keep looking. Kali like looks up at the sun. We've got a couple more hours.
Well, what are you looking for? Because you didn't like the cave, and this is an overhang. Are you looking for more caves, or is Jenko going to climb the rest of the way, or are you looking for motel inn?
Ideally, a spot where we can get as close to a 360 as possible to see as much of the landscape around us.
Okay,
as
so just, like, one angle. A 360, no, because you're in a mountain range.
Right.
Okay, so you either got to go to the top of the mountains if you want a 360. No, there's, okay. You have, I mean, you have a 180 of what's in front of you. You know what I mean? Like, if you're... I don't know how I can explain this any better, but I'll do a top-down view. Where you got these mountain peaks that are intersecting each other, right? These are the mountain peaks. And you guys are kind of nestled in right here on this big sort of solid section. So you can kind of see out to here. But at a certain point, the mountains are going to cut you off to the point where you can't see anything beyond this view. And like, there's going to be parts of the mountain that jump out to here. So you're never going to get a full 180. You're never going to get a 190. You're never going to get more than a 180 because you're in a mountain range. So unless you climb onto the top of the mountains, which again, there's a risk. You got to risk versus reward. You got to pick your battles. You got to choose if you want to take the risk or you got to settle with the results.
Yeah, I think if we can get a decent ways off of the sand, at and we're like in between some rocks, that's pretty solid. I think we should hunker down there. Nothing as deep as a cave because the cave might be inhabited, but it's a deep enough crevice to where if wind starts to blow or there's a sandstorm, we have some cover. But I think first things first, I'd really love to check out the view of the other things, because that's one of the reasons we came here. Get as high as I can without actually climbing and check the smoke plumes.
Absolutely. I feel like we're already as high as we can get. Same. Unless we're not. But like Alex said, our view is already pretty much a solid 180. Unless we go like to the very top of this range, we're not going to get more than like 180-ish. If we like peak over the top of it before we can do that.
Okay.
If somebody wants to come with me, I'd try to like get higher up and get above the lip of this mountain range, but it'd be dangerous.
Oh, the little bat fella doesn't want to die alone.
No, I want someone to die with me.
I do not think there is any real value to be gained from going higher.
Unless there was like a city that was visible just over the mountain, you know.
Yes, you can tell us about it as you go past on your way down.
I got an idea. I don't know if you're gonna like it, but I might as well say it since you're so insistent about you know, getting some ground. Well, I could lift you up, and I don't mean with my hands. And Roadie will you know, use his telekinetic abilities to lift up like a few rocks or something. Not trying to show off, but like, I could just lift you, you know, up in the air pretty high and you could look and tell us what you see.
Oh, you're just gonna just casually tell us that? What the fuck? Is it telekinesis?
Are you using magnets? Is this magnets?
Is it? Okay.
Oh, are you guys, all right. Well, sure, I'm using magnets. Do you want me to magnet you up there or what?
Wait, what'd you say? Sorry.
Yeah, I'm using magnets. Do you want me to magnet you up there or what?
Yeah, I'm not opposed, but my first question is, did you really have what's-his-face paying you shit to just be his muscle when you have that ability? What the fuck? It's pretty useful.
Well, to answer your question, yes. So do you want me to leave you with my magnets or what?
Yeah. I'm down. Just don't drop me.
That is a very real danger. Are you sure that you wish to do this? We haven't even tried looking out at the landscape here.
Okay.
We climbed up and none of us said, hey, let's look out before we send Michael into the fucking ether.
What if I try to climb up as high as I can go and then you catch me if I fall? Can you do that or is that just, like, too much?
What if I roll a notice wisdom check and see what I can see?
I mean, I guess I could try that. I don't know why you wouldn't let me just lift you up. With my magnet.
Can you lift me? Like, a couple feet? A couple hundred feet? Like, what are we talking about? I can't fly, by the way. I don't have wings.
That's a good question. Alex, how far do my abilities
I want to say about 100 feet or so, maybe a little more. You're not going to be able to get him all the way up there. The book just says, because I was checking this while you were discussing about it, an object or a person with unaided visual range or within tactile contact with the psychic.
Yeah.
So I'm going to say you're going to be able to get him like half up the distance you need to, or like if he falls, you'd be able to start the process of like, let me catch him. You wouldn't have to do it last second. You're pretty confident that you'd be able to catch him.
All right. Then here's what I'll say. I can't get you all the way up, but I can get you pretty high. And if you want to just climb, I can try and catch you if you fall. Feel pretty good about it. Solid 9 out of 10, I could catch you, you know, but I mean, you want to risk 1 out of 10, I guess. But one thing, I'm going to ask that you keep this to yourselves, these magnets that I'm using. We agree that we're going to keep this to ourselves?
No.
Yeah, I agree to that.
I guess so, sure.
Sure. Why?
Did somebody
really need to know about magnets?
Whatever helps us live, man.
Who said no?
Sarah.
Is there a reason why you'd want to tell people about my magnets?
Maybe.
How do I put that? You sound real suspicious. Is she just being a pain in the ass, or does she look like she's up to something?
She's kind of always looked like she was up to something. You don't really know.
What?
She's got a tough exterior. Is she being a pain in the ass, or is she up to something? You looked at a lady. You don't know she's up to something is the answer. She doesn't have a suspicious look about her, but she's got a rough exterior. You can't tell if she's just being a smart ass or if she has some secret plan to, I don't know, lobotomize all psychics.
She's tapping her fingertips together and going, soon.
Yeah, you don't know.
How do you step towards her, ready to, like, I mean, he'll fucking throw her off the cliff. Now, is there a reason that you'd want to go telling somebody about my magnets?
Depends if it's worth telling.
All right, look, guys, I can already, like, feel the tension in the air, like a big kahuna and a wave, you know what I'm saying? We can't be fighting each other. Just let him use his magnets, and we'll worry about this later, okay?
Yeah, I'm not trying to fight anybody.
Good. Magnet him up.
Roadie
I'll climb up the rest of the way, and if I fall, I trust you with my life, unfortunately.
I don't know why. Unfortunately, I told you I could do it, probably.
Gosh. Okay. I mean, so what's the plan? What happens?
We're going to march up to the tallest, like, rock face, like, ridge, and see if we can get to the very top and look over and get more than 180.
Okay, no, but, okay, so, you, what do you do? It's the question. Do you start climbing?
Yeah, you're gonna climb, right?
Do you start doing that?
I mean, we'll start climbing after we find the best spot to see if we can get up and get more than a 180 view, is what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, the top of the mountain. So do you start climbing the mountain? You need to get to the top of the mountain. Do you start climbing the mountain to do that? Do you just start clambering up? That's the question. Like, what's the... You tell me the process.
You, right?
Let's walk up what we can walk up.
We did that.
You're already done. You're already there. We've already been through this. Yeah.
I'll have him just telekinesis me up as far as he can.
Okay, see, this is... Okay, so you're not climbing up. You're being brought up the first 100 feet and then trying to climb up the additional 100 feet from there.
Yeah.
Okay. Roadie, that you go with this plan, yes?
Yes.
Okay. You lift him up. You guys all watch as Janko just floats through the air. Gravity ceases to exist for the boy. As he kind of clumsily a little bit kind of starts going, like tilting forward and backward. The control is not 100% precise, but he is definitely going up at a steady pace. As Roadie extends a hand out, you can tell he's concentrating to keep Janko in the air. After about 100 feet, Roadie, you can feel your sort of psychic connection to the object you are trying to manipulate kind of waning. And Janko, you kind of sputter for a minute, like drop an inch down and kind of begin to hover again, like, whoa, whoa, whoa. You both kind of surmise that you're at about the limit of what Roadie's psychic abilities can handle unless the distance is closed again, be it Roadie getting higher or Janko getting lower.
Right.
Well, what did he say?
Roadie calls out.
I see your rock face. They can't see shit.
Janko is. Thank you. Thank you for being in this scene, Michael, and the fact that, yes, you know, you're right in front of a rock still. presumably going with the plan, you're able to cling to the side of the rock for a second, Janko. You're able to pull yourself closer and cling to it manually. Okay. If you'd like to go higher, I'm going to need an exert strength check.
All right, I'm going to call down. If or when I fall, just catch me before I turn into a red mist at the bottom.
Catch him with the magnets, dude.
You will not be a red mist. You will be a red paste. Like your boss.
I point to Roadie.
As you point over to Roadie, can you give me a notice wisdom, Weevil?
8.
With an 8. With an 8, you hear as you point over to Roadie, and look, everybody else yelling back and forth and looking up towards Janko, clung 100 feet up above them, two thirds up the side of this mountain. You are able to notice sort of a pair of horns creeping over the rock face, sort of below you, back the way you came. This sort of hooved, scaly backed, horned beast of burden is kind of grumbling and growling its way up. And you notice a pair of horns, despite this thing only having one, as you see a second one sort of in tow, kind of rear its ugly head next to its friend, as it is sort of getting one, two hooves, its front hooves, up on the sort of the outcropping that you guys are all currently standing on, that 15 by 20 foot wide outcropping that you guys are sort of perched on at the moment. And so two of these things kind of show up on the edge and begin kind of sort of letting steam out of their nostrils and grumbling and growling at you guys, like almost like bulls getting ready to charge.
We are not alone.
Great. Do I notice this thing?
As you turn down and you see Weevil kind of look over and point for a second, and the rest of the party begins to look over, you are able to see over as well, as these things are coming up almost like from underneath the outcropping that you guys are on. So they weren't like super visible to you while you were climbing there, but you look down and you're able to see them from a bird's eye view. Yeah.
Great.
Awesome. Oh God. Hey Sam, I think it's time to get that gun out.
Who the fuck is Sam?
Her name was What the fuck's her
Sarah.
Name?
Sarah.
Sarah. All right.
She looks at you and she goes, "Who the fuck is Sam?"
Sam, Sarah, I just met you.
She's like unclipping the bolts or like the fastener on her holster so she can easily get her gun out as she says this. Like she's already on it, but she's like, "Who is Sam?" She's like, "I don't. You know, if I'm going to save your life, well, you might as well learn my name, all right?" And she, like, has... She's ready for a quick draw. She's kind of backing up a little bit, too.
I also slowly like... Yeah, Weevil turns his pointing finger, and the tip swivels open on the index finger that's pointed out, and a tiny little of a laser pistol barrel protrudes from his finger. And he's literally like doing like a finger gun with his hand, and slowly backs up too. And he's like, "Yeah, sorry.
Is it wise for us to engage? Perhaps they are friendly."
Dude, Alex, do they look friendly?
Not particularly.
Do they look like they eat meat, or like they just kill things with their horns?
Jenko thinks that question to himself and realizes the answer probably doesn't matter. Whether they're gonna eat your meat or just kill you with their horns.
I am not made of meat.
They don't, you know what, they're actually herbivores, but they kill for fun. Does that make you feel better?
Right. Yeah, that's what I was worried about. They're fucking land orcas. It's great.
No, they're, you don't know what that, you don't know the answer to the question, but you realize the answer is a moot point.
Okay, I'm gonna just try to cling to the rock, and assuming they can see me, I'll just try to very carefully climb up. You know, first I'm gonna try to hide.
Okay. I watched an animal show a long time ago, and it said that if you try to act really big and loud, you might scare off the beast. Maybe we should do that.
Yeah, you do that. I'm gonna take a step back.
You guys are all very slowly taking small steps back while these things take very small steps forward. The distance are, it's not exactly closing, but you're running out of room to backpedal on. Jenko, you're pretty sure these things haven't clocked you as you're so far the fuck up, and they don't look like they fly. So you're pretty sure you're already hidden for now.
I would like to roll to see if I recognize these things at all and know anything about them, or if they are like completely alien.
Sure, I think give me a. I think no int would be
maybe, you know.
No int would be easy enough to see if you can search any databases, any bestiaries you have.
9.
You feel like you've heard of these things before, because they are semi-popular beasts of burden on many sand planets. They can be domesticated and ridden and shit like that, but wild ones seem like wild animals, like from your the signs you're picking up on as you're kind of bioscanning these things real quick, like hyper focusing on their hooves and their horns and their expressions and the tufts of their jaws, or sort of the sort of shifting of their jaws rather. You're like, well, this is a wild animal and it looks agitated at the moment, even though I know that these things can be quite gentle.
Right, so this is like facing down a charging bull, essentially. Very, very dangerous, even if not all of them are.
You and Sarah.
Hmm.
Should we focus fire or split?
Well, we're running out of room, so I think we either shit or get off the pot. We can jump all down, right. Or I don't know, if you want to try and fucking ride one of these. Otherwise, she begins to very slowly draw her pistol from her holster.
I'm way ahead of you. Just say the word.
And Weevil aims his finger gun at the one on the left.
And she goes... Wait, what?
I was just going to say, Collie pulls out his vibro staff, but that's about it.
Okay, Collie starts fumbling for his staff on his back, getting ready.
He's now really the time. That is disgusting.
doubles as a sex toy, great. And she's like, she kind of looks over her shoulder at Roadie and Collie, and she's like, you boys might want to stay behind me. And fucking Kitz, of course, too, is cowering. He's already, like, scuttered all the way back to the edge. He's like, I have nowhere else to go! She looks over at you, Weevil, and she's like, all right, word. And as she begins to draw her pistols and makes a sudden movement, these things are going to charge. And we're not going to roll initiative, but we're going to end it here and roll initiative next time.